Are you recording this?
Hey, good evening, everyone, and welcome back to my YouTube channel. So today is Thursday, and this is the last day of November. And you know, for those, November was Tesla's birthday. So essentially, Tesla is 1 year old, and it's crazy. And that's why I named the title of this show is Tesla is still the best investment vehicle out there. At least from my perspective, I haven't really dabbed into other type of investment strategy. I just only in high yield dividends, and among the high yield dividends, Tesla is still one of the best. I love Tesla, and it have tremendous effect on my portfolio. So today is, you know, I got a couple of things I'm gonna do in my quick monologue. First, I gotta switch my music. Let's do that first, all right? And there you go, good chill music. And I'm gonna do a quick monologue here. I'm just gonna give a quick background for we got a lot of new people come visit our YouTube channel, and we got a lot of people and new people to Discord, and we have a lot of people new to just the community and by and large. And so I just wanna orientate people like where everything all started. Every Sunday on the first week of the month, which is this Sunday coming up, I'm gonna do a PowerPoint version of this. So I'm actually gonna talk from a PowerPoint. And I do that for like good 30 minutes or so, because I'm going step by step. And that's just orientate the entire community to stay focused. And because there's a lot of anti-high yield dividends investing. You know, that's why we call ourselves the Khmers. Essentially, think of like the Mayans, the Mongols, the Hells Angels, all those motorcycle clubs out there. They consider themselves the 1% of society. We consider ourselves 1% of the investment world. I mean, it's truly a very small group of people who believe in this niche, because we're looking at income for financial independence, you know, so we can retire and do all that stuff. And that's why the naming convention came that way, and that's why, you know, I actually thought about calling ourselves the Mayans, but the thing was, the Mayans were already taken by some TV show, you know, so that's why. All right, let me just give you a quick orientation, and then I want to go through the Discord community. If you can see, our Discord is packed. There's a lot of people in Discord, and I want to give everybody a chance to talk and ask questions and dialogues and things. But I want to start with, why did I create the YouTube channel? So when I first started YouTube channel, this was like 7 years ago, this was my first YouTube channel. I created for the Cambodian community to help them out, to show them that there is a way to get out of poverty. You know, most of us are immigrants, came to the United States, we're brand new, and we're still trying to learn the language, trying to learn the culture, and trying to learn how to be American, to be a good American, a good citizen. And, you know, as a military officer guy, I always try to set the example of, you know, to be a good soldier, good Marines, good sailors, good airmen, good Coast Guard person. And, you know, so I try to set a good example. And so I created the YouTube, and I was just showing people, you know, how, you know, my lifestyle, eating, traveling, and all that stuff. There's two subjects I try to stay away from. One was relationship, talking about, you know, how to meet girls and stuff like that. I talk about relationship as a family, but not how to pick up girls and date. And I don't want to get into the manosphere atmosphere, because even though I like what they talk about, but we're not aligned. So because I focus more on family, husband, wife, kids, and stuff like that. And so I want, because that's the root, that's the foundation. And then, and the other one I didn't want to talk about was finance. I didn't want to talk about finance at all, because as soon as you talk about finance, it's not going to be the same YouTube channel at all. So for many years, it was like that. And then just last year, right before I talk about finance, my whole personal life was changing. I want to get out of rental business. I was making good money from rental business, and I want to get out of there because it's not passive enough. As a military officer, as I pick up ranks, I realized my time is just very expensive. Like, I'm traveling all the time, I'm doing things all the time, and the last thing I want to do is take care of my rental property. It's not passive enough. So I sold all that business, got out of the business, and I said, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to go into stocks. I'm going to go buy ETF and stuff like that and to go into investment. I already have a retirement plan. I always have a 401k. I don't need to replicate that. So I just need to do investment just to go make money, to generate income. Okay, so that was the decision why I want to go into investment. But really what it come down to was my YouTube channel. Like, why did I create this YouTube channel? I want to help the Cambodian community. I was like, I want to help this immigrant community. At first, because I'm retiring, I'm about to retire from the military. I'm not going to work anymore in a couple of years. And so my first problem solving was like, maybe I should be a lawyer. If I go back to the community as a lawyer, I can help them. I realized that being a lawyer, I'm just singly helping people, but I'm not helping collectively, and I'm just putting out fire. As soon as I put out this fire, another fire is going to happen. I'm going to make money, but I'm going to be busy. And I realized that actually the best way to help a community is actually teach them how to be an investor. And teach them how to be an investor is, to me, will help and grow the entire community. And because once you have an investor mindset, you're not going to be as risky as it is. You're not going to go out there and do risky behavior. You're not going to go out there like drunk driving, for example. You're not going to go out there and take drugs. You're not going to go out there and go to jail, because all those things aren't going to get you rich. You're not going to go out there and be a single mom. Not going to get you rich if you're going to be a single mom. Some single mom can be rich, but that number is very low. You're not going to get rich marrying some total loser. You're not going to get rich if you didn't go to school. You still can, but however, the journey is more difficult. So as a result, you tend to focus really quickly, because once you have an investor mindset, you tend to focus on the simple things, you know, essentially God, country, and core. You know, as a Marine, you know, I just focus on a very simple thing, and family, and that's it. And you just got to figure out how to make money that way. And I think the investor mindset is really what set the tone. And so you can see everything I talk about is always from the investor mindset, from that mindset. I want to share that with you on Sunday. I'm going to go through a PowerPoint slide much longer. But I just want to set that stage and condition. This is why I start the YouTube channel. I want to get into to help a whole community. But what I realized, it wasn't just the Cambodian community. There was the Mexican community, the Cuban community, the Canadian community. The Canadians are also immigrants too. The Russians, the Chinese, this immigrant all around the world, and they all came to the United States and they all need help. And my message resonated to them also. I was like, wow. So we got a lot of those people in our community, in our investment community. The other thing is this type of investment help out a lot of people, especially low income people, especially people with second job, third job, fourth job. And you know, they're constantly working all the time. I'll give you an example. A police officer, you know, it's already a dangerous job, but in order for him to make more money, police officer don't get paid a lot. People don't understand it. He has to be a bouncer. He has to go work at a club somewhere, which is another dangerous job, because you get fight, you can get shot at in a club and stuff like that. And well, guess what? Doing this type of investment style, he doesn't have to go work that second job anymore. He can just like chill and be it. So that's essentially my goal, is to teach people to be an investor and then to be financially independent. So you don't have to do that. And in order to, you know, so you can go fight your own dragons, whatever dragons out there, and go fight it. That's it. I just want to share that message. And then let me go back to the community here and see what everybody have to say. What do you all think of that message? I know some of you heard of this like 1,000 times already, but. Kalko, you just uncue your mic. So you want to jump in and say something?
No, I mean, I think it's great. I mean, I think a lot of people don't understand the concept of money or investing or really compounding ROIs. And I think what you're doing here is amazing. And, you know, I'm looking forward to learning from you.
Yeah, I appreciate it. Well, learn from me. I hope not. I'm just asking the question. But what what I hope you learn is from everybody else who's a lot smarter than me in the room.
Well, I mean, just like in the military, you know,
yeah.
You listen to everybody, you know what
yeah.
I mean?
Yeah.
We can't be knowledgeable of everything.
Yeah.
So there's investments and stuff that I may know that you don't know. And, you know, that's the whole idea. And that's why I love this group. I mean, yeah, I know we focused on Tesla, but, you know, there's options and availabilities for people, like you said, that's low income, that doesn't have, you know, $50,000 to $100,000 to invest in, mm-hmm. you know, give them the foundation and the basic groundwork to achieve greatness. And that's yeah. what you're doing here.
Oh yeah. Yeah. First of all, we always use Tesla because Tesla is the pretty girl in the room, but it's actually more than Tesla. It's high yield dividends. So, right now, there's multiple girls in the room. So we're like, well, I don't know which one is the most beautiful one. I happen to like Tesla and some other people like, I think KC, I don't know if KC is around. KC like to call the dirty QQY. She's the dirty girl. So he like her a lot. And there's other people like NVD, you know, NAVD. There's so many ones out there. But when we first started off this journey, there was just only Tesla, OARK, which she looked like Cathie Wood, and then Clip, you know, the Chinese girl sitting in the room. So there was only three girls. That was it. There's one that looked like Cathie Wood, and there's a Chinese girl in the room, and then there was Tesla. So your choice, you know. Oh, you have any? I'm sorry. Go ahead. Yeah. Calco, yeah. If you unmute your mic, I'm assuming you still want to talk more. That's why.
Oh no, I'm sorry.
So, what do you think of our description of of Tesla? Are you considered her the pretty girl in the room too, or are you looking at something else?
No, I mean definitely the pretty girl. trust me, I love money.
Yeah.
So I like to generate revenue. I have solid ROIs.
Yeah.
I do day trade options too. So I like. I like solid, I like easy money.
Yeah. What how long you been doing investment? I'm just curious.
Well, it was kind of funny because Jay Davis and I, we actually met on a Facebook group
yeah.
back in 2019, trading options, and you know, we got in the heavy in it during COVID.
Okay.
The downfall. You know, we were doing a lot of trading with Apple, American Airlines. We got burnt on some trading, but I've been trading since pretty much college, so 2010.
Wow, so you're pretty experienced in this stuff. How big is your portfolio?
So I've been married a couple of times.
Okay. That answered the question. That answered the question.
Yep. And
is one of them happen to be an ABG? You don't know what an ABG is. Asian baby girl?
No.
Oh.
I was stationed in Hawaii, my friend. I was at Schofield. But in Fort Lewis. No Asian babies. Yeah, you can kind of say because, you know, those toxic women have that grip over yeah. military men. They just know how to put their claws in us.
Yeah.
So, like, I just went through a divorce. There's been a couple of times where I've YOLO'd my portfolio.
Yeah.
On, you know, stuff that I really thought was, you know, going to be solid investments. And,
yeah.
You know, so my risk tolerance is more than most people's.
Yeah, you're probably a little bit more. Now you're probably a little more aggressive than before too.
Yeah, because I mean, as an individual, like anybody, mm-hmm. if you can do it once, you can do it again.
Yeah.
When you lose it, you strive to get it back faster.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, you know, Joey and I, Jay Davis, we talk a lot. And there's times where he's like, yo, why'd you go 500 call options on that?
Yeah.
Well, I averaged down and then I averaged down again, and you know, technical great, and you know, sometimes you do get burned.
Yeah, this is interesting. It's good to hear. You know, obviously you and I are, you know, we're not shared the same experience except our military experience. But you've been doing investment. I'm new to investment. Now, why do you believe in Tesla? Or what do you believe in a high yield dividend? Forget about Tesla, but the high yield dividends investing, especially the single stock ETF. You know, the one that Yield Max is running. What's your belief in it?
I don't care what the belief is. I care based on the ROI.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you can, a company can sit there and, excuse my language, feed us any bullshit that we want to hear.
Mm-hmm.
What it really comes down to is what's the performance, what's the ROI, and what's the structure? You know, and what I like about Tesla, they're doing what they say they're doing, they're paying dividends, and they're paying high yield. So for me, that's all I care about. You know, like Joey sat there and said that once it breaks a certain threshold that my yields are below 30%, I'm gonna go look for the next investment.
Yeah.
Because I day trade, and typically my day trading is 30%.
Yeah.
So I wanna sit there and have something that if I'm not gonna be, if I don't have to babysit it, I want that 50, 60, 80, 90, you know, yields on.
Yeah, that's the part that's I love like, about, I totally agree. That's the part I love about the Yield Max. I mean, just think about it. I start off, I didn't know how to buy it. I just buy when I have money. And the problem was when I buy, I don't know how to read the chart. I didn't know anything about investment. So I got money. I put money in there, $1,000 every month. And every time I get money, I just buy it, whatever price was. I didn't even look at the price. I didn't look at the when to buy it. I didn't know about the dip concept or the DCA. So I could have bought this thing at $13 back in January. No, but I ended up buying it at $17 and then of $16, $17. And then I bought it at $18. I put a lot of money at $18 and my average went up to $18 pretty quickly. But I could have bought it at $13. You know, I have money, I buy it. I didn't conceptually didn't understand it. I thought I during the time I thought if I can own more share, I will generate more income. But then there's also, you know, total investment. I didn't look at the total investment. I just look at share and investment. And but I'll tell you right now, those who bought this stock, if you're new to my YouTube channel, if you're new to the Discord, if you're new to this community, just think about this. You're buying this stock right now, $11.67. You're gonna get more than 50 cents of dividends. And December month, which is for January, if you buy now for January, oh no, the X date haven't come out yet. Yeah, so guess what? Yes. In about a week, the X date gonna come out. So you're gonna get at least more than 50 cents, okay?
Yeah.
For $11, yeah. Think about that. For $11, that's crazy.
Right, and that's where people, you know, don't understand. They don't understand that concept.
Yeah.
You know, another one, AMPY. You know, 63%.
Yeah.
And really, I think a lot of this, and this is where Joey's strategy comes in a little bit. That if you were a long-term investor, diehard, that you love Tesla.
Mm-hmm.
You could buy 500 shares of Tesla, say, mm-hmm. you know, just like COVID stock split, but then you could use TSLY as your hedge.
Yeah, to buy, or you could use TSLY income to buy Tesla.
Correct. Or you could sit there and say, like, say, like right now that we want to buy, you and I will sit there and say, we'll buy the December 31st, 2024,
yeah.
$500 call.
Yeah.
It may run us $6,000 right now.
Yeah.
Right? Who knows? I don't have it up right now. But we could sit there and say, you know what, we're gonna offset that by, we're gonna buy 5,000 shares of TSLY. Mm-hmm. So we hedged our investment in a sense for that long call a year out. So really by the time that long call comes to expiration, we picked up all the dividend payments. So really at the end of that year, we either made money or we broke even.
Mm-hmm.
Or you could just sit there and buy. buy the share price of Tesla and then, you know, hedge it, like you said, use the money to buy future calls.
Yeah, the thing is, you're able to generate income, man. It's just beautiful. And the thing is, a lot of people see this number, $11.67. So what they do is they compare it to the original at $20. Like, wow, $20, now it literally dropped like 40-something percent. You know, but that's only if you buy at the beginning. So that's number one. Number two, all those people bought at the beginning, they've been buying it ever since. So they DCA with it. That's not their cost average anymore. I don't know a single person, I haven't met one yet, who actually bought at $20 and never touch it again, you know? So every single person, their starting price is different, you know, or their cost average is different. So it's just crazy how this thing works. But what the beauty of it, so this is how I discovered about Tesla. I didn't know anything about stock investment, I'm brand new. So I just went into, I searched stock first, that's all it is. And I didn't know about ETF. I'm like, what is this ETF? I never heard of ETF. And when I think of ETF, I thought it was mutual fund. I'm like, I'm not buying mutual fund. I already have a retirement plan. And then I start reading about ETF. I start, you know, watching YouTube video about what is an ETF and stuff like that. And I learn a little bit more and I realize, oh, it's just ETF, essentially a collection of stocks that you can buy in and out, open. So essentially they treat it like a stock, but it's a collection of it. So a fund manager would manage it and generally give you dividends. I like, wow, this is great. I like that. It seemed like a lot more safer than just buying a single stock. And so I went in there. I did that. I did the ETFs. I just did the ETF screener. I try to find the best, you know, ETF. I look at SCHD. I look at all these things. I like, oh, these are good. You know, I look at the total package of it. But then I was trying to figure out, how do I screen for dividend yield? And mostly REIT. I was looking for REIT ETF because that's where I'm familiar with. And I went to the new launch, I went to the ETF screener. So in the ETF screener, they have this thing called dividends, if you click on this button, but you can also do filter. And I use the filter to sort out for REIT. And but one of the search method, I click on it in dividend yield, and Tesla came up. Now remember, this is like back in January, so there's only like 2 or 3 months. And the thing was, Tesla was brand new, and it paid like, and it came up. Tesla, Clip, and ORK, these three came up on a monthly payments. I'm like, what is this? This is kind of weird. So I click on Tesla, and during the time, they only showed like 99 cents. I was like, what the heck? What companies out there? What stock out there that was January 10th price was like $11, $12, $13, something like that. I can't remember what it was. $13 and paying 99 cents. I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe it. I could not believe it. It's just like, and so I didn't quite understand it. What I thought it was, so I went and read the description. So when you read the description, I did not understand a single thing. Yield Max, this is what I read. Yield Max, TSLA, so I'm like, oh, this is Tesla, this is good. And option income strategy, I did not understand what that mean. Option income strategy. And then it got even more complicated. The fund seeks to provide current income and cap gains on Tesla stock through a synthetic cover call strategy. I'm like, what the heck does that mean? I have no idea. So, but I bought it anyway. I bought a whole bunch of them. And I bought them all the way until July or August when I met Kenny. When I met Kenny, Kenny explained me what synthetic cover call is. So I thought when they do option trading, I thought they were doing, you know, day trading, you know, like buy, sell, buy, sell. A whole bunch of people in YieldMax just buy, sell continuously. That's what I thought. But no, option trading, something totally different, you know, totally different. But there's two things that I look into fund when I want to buy a stock, doesn't matter what it is. I look at the income, how do they make money? So like, you can understand how Coca-Cola make money. You can understand how McDonald's make money. You can understand how Walmart make money. And but some company, I don't understand how they make money at all. You know, like all those biochemical, company. How do they make money? What is it they're selling? What is their number one product? You know, what are they selling? So the first question I asked was, how does Tesla make money? And number two was, what can kill Tesla? You know, like what situation will this fund fail? And in that regard, there's only two things that can fail it. If Tesla filed for bankruptcy or Yilmaz filed for bankruptcy. Other than that, nothing affected. But when you try to figure out how does Tesla make money, that's not as easy as I thought, because I didn't understand what option trading is. And once you understand how option trading works, you realize the beauty of this thing. And I tell people this all the time, you know, when I'm speaking about Tesla to people, not everybody have the same background where they come from. So the way I explain it, it understood. So it's like walking to a mall and you see there's a tax service, you can do your tax. There's an accountant service, you can do your accountants and stuff like that if you have like a small business. And then there's an insurance company, insurance service, you can buy insurance. There's a bank service, you can go bank service. And then there's something called option trading service, okay, for your investment. So if you walk in there and there's a J Yilmaz service, if you give him money, he will charge you 1%, and in return, he's going to give you essentially 70% yield of your investment. Now, I would have a couple of questions on that. The first question I ask is, can I liquidate it? Now, if you hear somebody talk about liquidation, you can tell that person have real estate background. So like me, the first question I always ask is, how can I liquidate this thing quickly? Well, and then, Jay is like, yeah, it's easy. This is an open fund. All you do is buy, sell, trade, push at a button. You have E-Trade? Yeah, you just look on your phone, click on the mouse, and done. You buy and sell. You can in and out the position anytime. Wow. So you're going to give me 70% yield and can get in and out any time. That's unbelievable. That's once I understood that, that's why I went all in on Tesla. At that moment, I went all in on Tesla. I just like, bam. Because they're able to generate high income passively, and I can maximize that. You know, I can maximize that. I didn't care about all the other stuff. Why does an income investor care about, because a lot of time they always talk about this NAV erosion, capital erosion, whatever catchphrase of the day is. They're like, oh, look at this thing, $20, now $11. Well, that's your problem. Literally, that's your problem. Not everybody's problem. If you buy Tesla at $11, if you buy Tesla at $10.93, guess what? You made money. Because this thing is $11.67. Yeah. So it's whenever you buy into it. So they're using a very faulty logic on that. You can't just use $20 and say, here's down now. That's the same argument somebody used SHD and say, wow, SHD is making like 200%. Yeah, but they always use it from 2012. They never ever say 200% from January 21st. It's like the opposite of that. Matter of fact, if you started from January, if you started in 2021 to 2023, you're down. You're actually down. 1 year ago, you're down 8%. So, but you don't hear them talking about that. You know, see, they pick and choose when they want to talk about capital erosion and NAV erosion. That's how I knew there was a fundamental flaws with the logic. I never went to school in business. I never work in a day. I never count money for a living. I never, because that's not my profession. I never count money. But I understood it really quickly that the people who's telling me that it's wrong is coming from a very fundamentally flawed logic. Okay, let me just point out another logic. And so here's all the Yilmaz, all right? Here's all the Yilmaz. And they have 18 funds. Total combined is $1.21 billion if you combine everything. But look how many funds that's over $20. All right? And look how many funds that's under $20. But if you do plus or minus $1, look how many funds that's under $19. So we're talking about more than 10% loss is Nfly, Google, XOMO, ORK, and Tesla. There's only four funds. That's more than 10% loss. Because any, you know, plus or minus any given day, this thing may go up the other way. Essentially, there's only four funds, but out of the four funds, only two funds is like, have a lot. So how come they don't use that logic on this thing? So you see, that's where the flaws of the argument of it. And guess what? Here's the part I love about this. Here's the beautiful part about high dividends. They are generating more income every day. Yes, they are generating more income. There are new funds born every single day. Every single week, not every day. Every single week. There's not a week that there's... every week there's a high yield dividend income fund born. This week is AIYY. I haven't looked at all these guys yet. So I don't know if they're income fund or not. AIYY. Last week was THTA, that's SoFi. No, it's just, and so on. You can sort by it. The curve yield max. You know, EMCC back in the beginning of the week. Curve yield max came out with 6. IWMY, the Defiance, came out. I mean, it's just so many now. There's so many choices. At some point, man, we're moving on. and Tesla is beautiful. It's beautiful. I'm going to pause here. I'm going to give everybody a chance to talk. I think I monologue way too long. And I just want to kind of prep up this. Hey, guys, what do you think before I switch over and talk about my portfolio here and about the event today? What's your take on what I just said? Okay, so this is the million-dollar questions. People want to know what happened to my portfolio. Let me just recap it real quickly here. Before, I had $50,000 something in my portfolio, and I have negative $20,000 or $19,000 of margin. So that's negative $19,000. I have a whole bunch of portfolio. I have about 30 something assets that I manage. Well, today I sold everything. I sold all that except Tesla and SoFi. Now, the only reason I didn't sell Tesla and SoFi because they're down 1.66 and 82 cents. Maybe I can get a few bucks tomorrow because there's no rush for me to sell these two unless I have to. If I sell these two, it would be $3,150, let's say. And that will be add on to this. It will be $10,000. So I have roughly almost, you know, $11,000 that I can buy QQY. So it's 114 share I own right now. And so then I can essentially buy more share, maybe 500 more shares, and then I can own QQY and continue to grow that fund. All right. I have over 3,300 shares of Tesla. I have 1,500 shares of Clip. So essentially, my goal is to get $1,000 from QQY the first week. My second week, I'm going to get $2,000 from Tesla. And my fourth week, I'm going to get $1,000 from Clip. So that's going to be $4,000. $4,000 a month, every month, for the rest of my life. Just think about it, that's crazy. $4,000 for the rest of my life. You know, it doesn't matter where I'm at. I could be at home. I could be on vacation. I could be in school. I could be on the beach. Or I could be in jail. People always like me saying that. I could literally be in jail. I will make $4,000. And here's the beautiful part. If I ever deploy, this is great for military guys. if we ever go on a long deployment and you're not going to come back to the United States, I just put dividend reinvest right here, check it off, and kabam. This $4,000 going back into the system, regardless what I do, it's going to go back into the system. So think about this. In 10 months, that's $40,000 that's going to go back into my portfolio. That number is going to increase by $40,000. That's crazy. That's $40,000. Or you can just keep in the money market and just get $40,000 and just keep growing and growing. Every month you can get I'm going to get $4,000. And here's the beauty. Here's the beauty of this thing. To own QQY, to get $1,000 of QQY, you need 1,000 share. 1,000 share get you $1,000 because they pay roughly a dollar share, all right? So you need 1,000 share, that give you $1,000. 1,000 share at 1840 is about $18,000, all right? $18,000 to get 1,000 share. Well, if I'm getting $4,000 a month, all I need is 5 months. In 5 months, I will get $1,000 of something else. I would buy something else. So right now I have $4,000. Oh, I will get $4,000 tomorrow, but I haven't bought yet. And then in 5 months, I'm able to get another $1,000. So now I become $5,000. And $5,000, I don't have to wait 5 months. I can just wait the 4 months. To get another $1,000. So essentially every 4 months or every 5 months I get $1,000. That's how fast it compound. It compound really, really fast now. Well, after I reach 6,000 a month, I don't need four months. I just need 3 months. Because 3 months times $6,000 equal to $18,000. Yeah. So it's crazy. It's gonna move really, really fast. This is why I'm so happy with my portfolio. I'm really, really excited about this. I literally can. I'm making more money. Let's just go to the dividend tracker. I didn't log in, so I don't know if it's.
I can't see your screen in Discord.
Oh shoot! Yeah, I'm sorry. I totally forgot about that. I forgot to log in dividend tracker. I was going to show you the dollar amount, how much I make. Give me a second. Let me log in. I got to go to a different channel and log in. Can you all see now?
Yes.
All right. Who is this talking? I'm sorry. And where are you from?
It was Chris.
Chris, where are you from, yes, man?
New York.
New York? Yeah, remember, Maury want to know, like, where you from? He's all about where you...
Yeah. I'm on Long Island, New York, in Bethpage.
Oh, man.
Long Island. Yeah.
Must be nice.
I'm right by Grumman, where they built the lunar module.
Yeah. So what do you think of the investment portfolio? What do you think of Tesla?
Well, I'm in it. You know, I have about how many shares? I have about 1,400 shares of Tesla, and I have 1,000 shares of QQQY at this point.
Holy cow!
Yeah.
You're kicking my butts, man. I remember when you started off.
Oh no! Well, you're definitely ahead of me. But I think people need to realize the compounding part of it.
Yeah.
I think you know, you got to reinvest those dividends.
Yep.
And that's when it's going to compound.
Yeah. And here's the thing, you don't have to reinvest back into Tesla, like, because they all pay high yield. They all pay 60 to a dollar. So like, for example, I'm taking my Tesla dividends. You don't have to put it back into Tesla. You can. That's probably ideal. But guess what? I'm buying QQY, and they pay high dividends. So you can do, or you can buy Clip and stuff like that. So think about this, guys. This is crazy, okay? You just saw my portfolio. I'm not making this up. This is my Charles Schwab account. It's not some Excel spreadsheet. It's not some funky math where I'm gonna make fun, you know, that I just made this up. That's 3,300 share. That's 1,500 share. That's 114. And tomorrow I'm gonna get more share because I'm not gonna buy it until this price drop. So at 4:00, this price gonna drop 93 cents. Let me pull the calculator real quick. Could somebody tell me what's the price for QQY? What was the dividend rate? Anybody remember? I didn't.
I believe it's 93 cents.
So minus 93 cents. All right, not minus 93 cents. 17.47, all right? I may get it at 17.50, all right? So tomorrow at 4:00 in the morning, this thing gonna drop to 17.50 at 7:00 when Charles Schwab open for trade. I don't, can somebody else buy? If you're an E-Trade or M1, can you buy before 7:00?
I don't think so.
Okay, so everybody's the same boat. Okay, so at 7:00, I'm gonna put a bid for 17.50. And I would be able to buy the number of share that I want right here. And then I would own QQY. And here's the beauty part. This number here is without QQY. I don't have Chippy anymore. I sold that. But this is Clip, QQY, and Tesla. Okay? Let me delete this real quick. I can't delete it. So I want to be as accurate as possible for all of you. All right. So I have 1,500 shares of Clip, 114 shares of QQY, and 3,300 shares of Tesla. All right? I'm generating $3,000 a month income. $3,000 a month. I can't wait to add tomorrow. When I add tomorrow, this is going to go up to $4,000. Essentially, I'm making an annual income of $36,000. This is essentially a high school teacher pay salary, entry-level starting salary right here. If I want to be a high school teacher in Wyoming or in Minnesota, right there, there's a salary for a high school teacher. Out of college, this is a salary for a sergeant. If you're a sergeant in the Army, right there, you're getting paid $36,000. Now, granted, you got to pay some taxes, but yeah, same thing as high school teacher. They make $36,000 minus taxes. There you go. This is all just from dividends. And how big is my portfolio? It's $76,000 right now. Obviously, if I sell this number gonna drop. But $76,000. For $76,000, I'm making, it's more than 76, minus 11,000, plus 11,000, so about 86,000. So for $86,000, roughly, I'm getting $36,000 in a year. This is beautiful. This is why I love this thing. You tell me when this thing gonna fail. You think Tesla's gonna fail tomorrow? No, we know that. Everybody knows that. Tesla's not gonna fail tomorrow. Somebody shot Elon Musk. Guess what? Tesla's continuing to make money. Tesla is not gonna fail tomorrow. Is Yield Max gonna fail tomorrow? No, I don't think so either. So, yeah, we're going to be fine. We're going to be fine. I'm getting $3,000 a month, every month. So this is the beauty of these things. I love these. I love these visual. The biggest thing that I am excited about is my goal is to get $5,000 a month. I'm 61% there. In January, I'm going to get $4,000 a month by January. By January, this number is going to go up to 4,000. Guess what? I'm only 1,000 short. I have from January all the way to December to get $5,000 a month. Yeah, at this rate, I'm going to get more than $5,000 a month. I'm probably going to get maybe $7,000 a month by the end of the year. I'm just estimating. I haven't really calculated. It's crazy. It's just crazy math right now. It's just crazy. And the thing is, I'm going to end up owning. I'm gonna own QQY, which is gonna generate 1,000. I'm gonna own either Jeppy or IWMY, that's gonna generate me another 1,000. of course, Clip and Tesla. By that time, of course, I'm continuing to grow Tesla and Clip. So this number is going to increase to 3,500 maybe. And Clip is continuing to grow too. At some point, I'm going to diversify. I'm going to buy my third week. I don't have a third week yet. So maybe after QQY, I get my third week. So then every week I get paid. I get paid a week. I get paid from QQY, I get paid from Clip, I get paid from Tesla. And then my third week, I get paid from Curve Yield Max or something, TSLP or something like that. That'd be awesome, man. This is the beauty of it. This is why I love it, and this is why we love it. And this is why we all can say, hey, we have saw magic. We have touched the wall. Like, I have flew to the island and touched the wall, touched the statue. I think I've gone on long enough, so I want to share and talk to everybody about their investment strategy. First of all, Maury, did you see my portfolio? What do you think of this? Maury, you there? Oh, Maury was so excited to talk, but now he's... Hey, Mike, how's it going? Mike Brood, well, welcome to Discord, man. This is the first time I see you. How are you doing? Are you able to talk? Okay. Well, anybody can jump in. Otherwise, I'm going to continue on here. All right, I'm sorry. Hey, Mash. How's it going?
Hey.
Yeah.
Pretty good, man.
So what do you...
Yeah, I don't know if you remember. I came on in, probably back in October.
Okay.
And then talked a little bit. I was the one that was a police officer, the one you were talking... I don't know if I was the same person talking about or a different person.
Oh, that was you. I was telling you a story. Are you the police officer who worked at a bouncer?
Yeah. We call them extra jobs.
Yeah, extra job. Yeah. Yeah. So does that make sense now? I mean, my friend?
Yeah, exactly. You know, I was also in the Marine Corps. I can know, you know, 03 to 07, I got out.
Oh, really? Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah,
what unit
you
know,
I didn't realize you were a Marine too. Yeah. I was with 2nd LER.
Oh, dude, you probably know some of my friends. I can't say, I don't know if
oh,
I can.
I'm alone. I'm...
No, because that's like, the same time. Yeah, I know all the guys in 2nd LER. I mean, I don't know all the, I don't know the enlisted side. I know the officer, like the lieutenants.
Oh, no, I mean, this is a long time ago, so.
Wow, what a small world. I miss some of the guys.
In Philadelphia, I'm a cop in Houston.
Yeah. You said 2nd LAR, that's right? From 03 to 07? Yeah, from the invasion all the way to 07? Yeah, I know all your lieutenants. I miss it. Oh, man, those guys.
He was Lieutenant Steele. I don't know if you know. Roland Steele.
Yeah. Yeah. You had a guy named, Boomer? A Boom?
Man, I don't know. I can only because I was enlisted, so I only really knew my lieutenant.
Yeah.
And then our battalion commander.
Who's your battalion commander?
His name was Lieutenant Colonel Renfort.
Yeah. Wow.
Renforth, yeah.
Oh, man, those cat, man, 2nd LAR, man, they're crazy, man. I remember a couple of the lieutenant, man, they just want to fight all the time. They love it, man. McMap was like the biggest thing. I don't mind fighting. I don't mind. But I'm not a wrestler, you know, like some of these guys are wrestler. I mean, you know, back in college and stuff like that, and back in the Naval Academy, and oh man, they love it, man. They're like, hey, we could be in the middle of the class. They'd be like, hey, let's go and fight. All right, let's go. It was just crazy, man. It was just a fun time. That's why I love Oh man, what a great community. So what do you think of this investment journey?
I mean, I'm kind of on it too. You know, I'm more diversified in the yield max funds. Mm-hmm. I'm not in all in one. I'm kind of spread out.
Yep.
200 in Tesla, about 300 in Kony.
Yeah.
Couple hundred in Netflix, couple hundred in Nvidia. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I started in August with S-Ball because I was just researching high yield and I found that one and I was like, well, that's not really high yield, but I bought some of that. And then I found that I saw the Jay's interview on one of those channels.
Yeah.
I think the armchair guy.
Yeah.
And that sold me on Tesla and then I bought Tesla. So I think I made like $40 in August and
yeah.
September, I was like 180 and then October I made 600 and I think I'll probably make 1200 for this month.
You're going to make enough to quit your job soon.
Yeah. No, I mean, I got.
I thought you already have 2,000 shares of these $2,000 worth of it. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I'm confused between you and the school teacher.
Oh, no. I have my highest one is QQQY. I have 455 shares right
yeah.
now. And I bought 355 of that after the X date last time.
Okay.
Well, I've only been paid $100 from it so far, but this month I'm going to get paid $400-something.
Dude, keep growing it, man. Keep growing it and make money so you don't have to be a bouncer anymore. It's dangerous. Well, wait, are you in Philly? Maybe I'm talking to the wrong guy. Are you in Philly?
No, I mean, maybe. I'm in Houston, so I don't know. You're maybe talking about somebody else. But yeah, I did come on in October and I talked to you. I told you I was working a lot of extra jobs at clubs and stuff.
Yeah.
I was doing about $1,250 a week investing. I was trying to invest about $1,250 a week.
Yeah. So you're making that? Are you taking that money from being a bouncer and then putting into fun, or are you just spending on your wife and kids?
Well, I mean, I mainly do whatever cash I make at the end of the night. I keep it all the way until the end of the week, and then I put deposit it. And I've been working overtime with the city, so sometimes I'll.
Yeah.
Whatever's left over from my paycheck, I'll put in there. So I've been averaging probably about $5,000 to $6,000 a month investing, starting in August.
Yeah.
So now I'm right around like almost 30,000.
Yeah. God bless you, man. This is when people like there's some form of elitism. Also, I have to say elitism, probably the right words. You know, because my dad is a roofer. He put new roof on top of people's homes. It's hard labor, man. It's hard labor. It's like I couldn't do it. Like I went there and watched him work, and I could not do. They're doing a hot baked sun, and they, you know, moving up, you know, the material up to the roof, and they just nailing it in there. It's just hard work. And then he told me that's not hard work. You should see the paver, the guy who paved the driveway. That's hard work. And so, and then when you talk to the paver, when they show up, I say, well, you think this is hard work? You should see the guy who worked on the city street that paved the street, the city street. And that's hard work, you know? So like every echelon is somebody who's harder worker than you. But all of them have in common is that nobody wants to do this job for the rest of their life, okay? And they all want to quit, but they can't quit. You know, they're just going from jobs to jobs to jobs. And by doing this type of investment, it gives them, they don't have to keep working. They can just work a few projects here and there and make some money, and this investment will help them move the needle to the next, you know what I mean? Because their body's getting old. Their body is just getting, it's tough on the body. So now they can just say, yeah, you know what? This month, I'm going to take it easy. You know, they can do that with this type of investment. Are you thinking about doing that, Marsh? Or?
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, my regular day job is awesome. I love it. I could do it for the next 20 years easy.
Yeah,
the thing is, I need the side income to kind of do what I want.
Yeah.
You know, with my wife and kids and stuff. So this is to replace my side income.
Yeah.
If I can get it to about $5,000 a month, then I'm like, okay, now I don't ever have to work extra again. I can just do my regular 40 hours.
Yeah.
And then have the rest of my time off.
So what do you think of my portfolio? I'm 3,000 now. I mean, when you and I talk, I don't have 3,000. I think I had like, I broke 2,000. And you were like, no, I broke 2,000 before that. Oh no, after that, I think. Mean,
it's good. No. I like watching. I use Schwab too, so I like going to the little investment income tab yeah. and watching the bars grow up every month.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm getting there. Dude, I need to add clip to mine. I don't have any clips, so I think I'm going to buy some more clip.
Well, clip is pretty cheap right now. I mean, $16. That's a pretty good price. And
yeah, I think I'm going to add some more clip to my portfolio. I don't yeah. have any clip yet.
That's, you know, if you... Yeah, there's a lot more choice there. You see, I do it based on pay. Like, that's why I don't go all in on Tesla. You know, like, I don't go in all the yield max. Because I don't want them all this... Not a word, all my money, I get paid once a month. I want to get paid four times a week. You know, I mean, four times a month. So first week, second week, third week. The only thing that's missing is my third week. My third week is going to be Curve TSLP, which that's going to be the next thing. So once I get $1,000 from QQY... I may just take that whole all that income and buy my third week Curve, you know, and grow it. Yeah, so that's
yeah. It looks really good. I mean, I hope I can get definitely gonna make some big buys at QQY tomorrow. On the next day, I'm probably gonna try to get 600 shares. I have a lot of money coming in tonight because my overtime check and then VA stuff. It's all coming tonight, so I'm gonna throw all that into QQY.
Oh, that's awesome, man. Yeah. That's awesome. No, I appreciate it, man. It's good to see you, man. 7 for 5, brother.
All right, you too.
Yeah. That's awesome, man. I love talking to Marines. This you know, I didn't realize how many veterans in this channel. There's a lot of veterans. There's a lot of soldier, though. That's kind of weird. I'm making fun of the soldier.
It cracks me up every time you do it, too.
Why, are you a soldier, too?
No, I'm a Marine.
Good. Well, simplify, Jay Davis. I didn't know.
What, gunnery sergeant, retired. We've talked before.
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah, I remember. I apologize. You can imagine I meet, like, hundreds of people now. And, you're the one who tried to trick me and see if I make up some story or something like that, huh? You were like, what's your MOS? What's your background? What's your platoon number? What's your number?
Hey, you know,
that sounds like Joey.
Hey, every time I go to the VA or I go somewhere, you people, and then they tell you everybody was either a recon or everybody was a Navy SEAL, but nobody did normal jobs in the military.
You know, okay, let's make fun of the soldier real quickly here. You know, when I do a lot of flying, so I travel a lot, and every time I'm at the airport, you know, I wear my shirt. You can see my shirt here. This is not a Marine shirt. This is a the strike group. I was on the strike group, and this is the George Washington. Yeah, this is George Washington. I have so many shirt. And so this is the USS George Washington. So I'm sitting there drinking beer, my own business, or sometimes my Marine shirt, you know, Marine hat or whatever. And so there was this soldier came up to me. He started talking to me. He's like, you're a Marine? I was like, yes, of course. I'm like, you still in it? Of course I'm in it, man. I love it. I love the Marine Corps. And he's like, what about you? I was like, yeah, you know. And he started talking. I said, so what do you do for the Army? Oh, I'm in Special Forces. Really? That's a lot. I mean, you know, there's not that many of them. It's kind of rare to find a Special Force guy. I like you know, what are you, like Rangers, like, are you Green Beret or what? And he's like, oh, you know, my special is so special, man. Well, it's top secret. I'm like, you realize, in case you did not know, I'm a military officer, you know, I think I know the organization. I may not know the detail, but I pretty much know every military organization, you know, at this point in my life, you know. If I was a brand new lieutenant, maybe I don't know it, but I've been in the military, like, you know, for a while now, you know. I'm pretty sure I bump into them. So what are units, you know? They're like, oh, you know, yeah, we do all these, you know, secret missions, you know, when the ask and call, we go out and do these, you know, you know, like snooping, pooping stuff. You wouldn't, you know, you wouldn't. And I'd be like, seriously, come on, man. You know, like, you don't want to tell me your units. Cold. You don't tell me you're from. And then so I point out the flaws with him. I say, you know, here, I'm gonna make fun of the army. I said, I've been traveling for a while, sir. I just want to give you perspective. Up to this point, I have not met a single cook or a single admin or a single truck driver. Like, do they exist in the U.S. Army? A single supply? Like, every single person you meet as a soldier in special forces. Like, do you all work in the Ranger the battalion? Like,
no. No.
You understand what I'm talking about, Calco? I bet that must have drive you nuts, man.
No, I mean, yeah. Especially, like, you can vouch, or not vouch, but you can get a grasp of somebody when they're like, oh, I'm with the 75th Ranger Regiment. Oh, what bat? They're like, what do you mean? All right, go away. I already know you're a nobody. So a lot of it is just, like, fine-tuning what they're really trying to say. I mean, yeah. The infantry, they all think they're special forces, like, oh, we're all hurrah, we're gonna go kicking some doors and all that bullshit.
But, yeah.
You know, it's... You also get a lot of people, like, that go to Pathfinder or Ranger School or Assault that aren't in the spec op community.
Yeah.
Like, congratulations, you got tab, that's all you did.
Yep.
Well, then you go back here.
Mash, go ahead.
I was gonna say also, like, in my unit, it sounds like Special Forces, but it's not. We refer ourselves as lazy ass recon, but we're not. You know, it's light armor reconnaissance, so it's a little bit different. We don't do anything. We're just basically a regular infantry unit.
Yeah, I mean, the Marine Corps doesn't have a Special Forces team.
We do.
Well, they have MARSOC, yeah.
Yeah, we have MARSOC. They, you know,
okay, MARSOC came into existence when?
When I was in, it came in 03, I believe.
Yeah.
03 or 04, right. My first MU deployment, MARSOC was their first active deployment. And they actually got in trouble because I think there was a controversy on that deployment where there was a bunch of civilians that were killed in Iraq, and then they tried to fuck them over, but it ended up turning out to be a whole bunch of BS.
Yeah, yeah.
That sounds like the Blackwater crew.
It was like it was MARSOC's first platoon deployment. They were attached to our MU.
Yep.
And then they went off to Iraq to do some mission, and then
that was the 22nd MU. I think it was the 22nd MU. That's right. Were you in 22nd or 24th? That was the 22nd.
It was the 26th MU, I believe.
Oh, 26th MU. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. But,
I was. I was attached to 22.
Okay, yeah. No, I remember that story. What you used to say, I remember that story real well.
For us, though, MARSOC didn't go to the SF games until, like, I think it was 06, 07. So that's when we could sit there and be like, all right, they're a semi-high-speed unit. Yeah, their existence started in 03, but until you get invited to the games.
Yeah.
And most people don't even know there's like, it's 14 to 21 days. And it's all SF games.
Yeah.
And it's you got Rangers, SEALs, SF, and it's actually pretty fun.
That's interesting, man. No, it's good. It's good rivalry, man. You know, we have a lot of veterans here. I think, you know, it makes sense because I tend to gravitate toward, because I talk about military a lot, and we tend to gravitate toward that. And it's good. It's good to see. It's good to see a lot of veterans in the community. I'm really happy, man. We got some guy who is in the. He said he was in the as admin for the Air Force.
At least he's honest.
Yeah.
Hey, I mean, without the admins, I'm pretty sure none of us would have got paid.
Yep, that is true. That is true. Yeah, so I'm just excited about you know, this portfolio. So I want to share. That's really my message. for today. And so I want to give everybody else a chance and talk about their portfolio. I have a couple of questions, and does anybody else have questions? Because we have a lot of people in this channel and Discord right now that can literally talk about. I'm just curious about your portfolio, and how do you think you're gonna grow and get bigger? Just go ahead and unmute your mic and just jump in and say something. Yeah, go ahead, Marsh.
Well, I had an idea. I wanted to see what maybe your community thought about. I have a 453B, right, with the city that I work for. And it currently has like 70-something thousand in it. And I could borrow. It's like a loan for myself. You know, and I've been kind of kicking this idea around. So it doesn't, I could borrow like 34K. And it's like I'm borrowing money for myself. So all the interest gets paid back into the account, and the only thing I really would pay is like just the fees. I think it's like $75, mm-hmm. $25 a year, or something, $24 a year or something like that. And I don't know if I want to do it or not. I think it's a lot cheaper than buying anything on margin, because the interest rate's only like 5.25% or 5.5%. I just wonder if anyone had any thoughts on that.
Yeah, a lot of people. All right, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Really, I mean, that comes down to, and this is where Joey would come in, because he's done a lot of the math on, you know, utilizing margin versus pulling from 401ks, even, you know, he's talked about pulling from a credit card. As long as the ROI yield will outperform what your interest rate or penalties or whatever will be, it costs you in a sense to take that money, then it's in your benefit. And that's where you're really going to have to put pen to paper, do the mathematics of it, and see, you know, what your ROI, you know, kind of like run it as a business in a sense, and evaluate what your cost to take the money versus what you're going to generate off the money. And that's when you'll find out if it's an actual smart idea and which avenue to take.
Dwayne just want to go ahead. Dwayne, good to see you, brother.
Nice to see you too. I haven't been on in a little while. But a question like this, I definitely got to put my 2 cents worth in. Anytime you're making a play in the stock market, there's risk. And you need to measure your risk assessment. Myself, I'm in a similar situation. I have a 403B through my work. I am not touching that. What I'm doing here, playing with Tesla and some of these other high yields, there's risk. There is risk. Don't let anyone tell you there's not. And are you willing to put your established retirement plan at risk or not? And that's something only you can answer. Myself, I've got PERS, I've got a 403B, plus I've got another retirement account. And those are in no way affected by what I do with Tesla. Now, I got margin in other ways, in my account. But, you know, are you willing to lose that retirement if something bad happened? If you're going to go gamble that loan.
Go ahead, X.
Hey, guys. I was just going to say, this is strangely appropriate for things that I've been doing on my own that I would never advise other people to do, you know, generally. But it's just a matter of, you know, debt arbitrage, basically. You know, in this particular instance, the gentleman who was speaking is taking it, you know, the money from their own account. So what Dwayne's saying is 100% true. There is risk involved, but he is correct that the risk is somewhat mitigated by the fact that it's actually himself that he's paying back. So it is possible to have the income earned from the funds not necessarily bring enough to the table to make the debt that you accrued, even if it is from yourself, worth it. It's unlikely, in my opinion, but it is possible. So you do have to consider that. But the other thing that you should consider in that example before making that removal is the shed of the value of the income through time. The time horizon is very important. If you take, let's just say you said there was 70 grand in there. Let's say like a 401k, you can borrow up to half of that, you know, fund. PPP accounts and different pension funds is usually 50%. But let's say that you take half of the money, it's 35 grand. If you put that 35 grand to work in a high yield fund, the likelihood is that the output is going to far outstrip what you owe yourself on a month to month basis. However, how long does it take for you to meet that debt repayment obligation? Because through time, you're no longer taking the proceeds from the high yield shares and putting them back into the fund. Reinvesting dividends is a crucial, integral part of maintaining the value and output of the fund with these high yielders, because the share price statistically, historically, has a tendency, for obvious and otherwise reasons, to deteriorate through time. But as that share price deteriorates, so does the output of that account. So if you have 35 grand in there and it's spitting out 40% yield, let's say, a year later, that 35 grand is not going to be 35 grand. It's going to be 31 grand, 28 grand, whatever the shed of the share price is. That's important in your example, because that share price, let's say the account's now worth 28 grand, that same 40% payout is going to be 40% of 28 now, not 40% of 35 like it was the year prior. And if it's going to take you many years to repay the money that you borrowed, you do have to account for that shed, not only in value, that's less important, but more important, the shed in output that the shares are going to give you through time. Because maybe it's making enough money for today to pay back the debt obligation, but will it be making enough next year and the year after that, commensurate with that, whatever amount you're borrowing, of course. So it is something to give thought to, as well as the risk associated with doing something like that in general.
JD, you want to? Oh, Marsha, you want to say something? Or JD, did you unqueue your mic earlier?
Yeah, I just unqueued it to tell to risk reward. Some of the arbitrages that we did before this was done, like, you know how they send you the credit card offers for like 10 grand at 0% and you could transfer it to your bank. We would do that because we knew that they would charge us 3% and we know we could pay it back via within 7 to 8 months, and then doing that leverage investing. But with a 401k, only questions I would have for them is, can you pay more than just the minimum through payroll deduction? And if you can, how fast can you pay it back? And then if you are going to do that, start small by taking a $1,000 loan, put it in there, let a few payroll cycles go by and see if you're up or down to test the waters. And then two, we used to do it with the TSP all the time. We would go in, take $5,000-$10,000 loan. We would set it up to pay back less than 12 months. And we would rinse, roll, repeat, so we could pull the money out of the retirement. And it would be at the G fund at that time. And we were getting 2-3% returns back on that money while we were waiting. So again, it's risk reward. I've got 5 different portfolios I manage. I've got one for just pure growth. I've got one just for pure income. The Income Factory, I love that. And then I've got this high yielder for that. So in short, you have to weigh your risk tolerance. Is it going to work, and how long is it going to take you to pay back, and then how fast can you rinse repeat it? That's why when Kamar was showing yesterday his portfolio and showing the margin, margin can be a good thing and it can be a dangerous thing.
Yeah, here's my 10 cents on it, and then I'll give it back to the community here. So to explain, first of all, a 403B is, he's a police officer, so these are nonprofit NGO retirement plan system. Each city, each state, they have their own, something similar to the 457 plan. But most of us know it's the 401k plan. So essentially, it's a tax-deferred retirement plan. So In other words, you put money into it. Sometimes the company or the city contribute the other, you know, the other 3%, and you're not taxed for it. You're going to get taxed when you withdraw the money, or when, you know, that's the advantage of this program. Okay, so I agree with Dwayne. I have a TSP, and one of the best thing ever happened is that I never touched my TSP, and that money is like ungodly amount right now. And so I would not touch it, no matter what. Don't touch it. Don't even look at it. Don't even try. Just take the money, because you're gonna get pension, and then you can maximize the loan when you're actually scheduled to pull out. So think of us as a retirement insurance. Like, worst case scenario for me, as long as I live to 59 years old, I can withdraw that money, I'm good. It's like, think of it like an insurance, backup insurance. So here's some suggestion though, if you wanna do something like that, take a look at the P loan. Most bank offer range from 7% all the way to 10%. My bank USAA offer 8% or 9%, depending on you. I don't know if you have USAA too. Most military guys have USAA. And so you can take loan from that 9%, easy. P loan at USAA is so easy. You don't even have to like call anybody. You literally go to your iPhone and click on, I want to borrow $5,000, $10,000. And you just click on a few buttons, and then they'll give you the money literally the next day. The next day you say P loan approved, and the money will go right into your account. And then what happened, they take money out of your checking account every month. Let's say you think of like a car payment. You say 3 years loan, 3 years, and you pay $150 a month. And $150 a month, you will pay off your loans in 3 years. It's a great setup, and you can pay anytime you want with that. And you can pay more if you want. So P loan's good. The HELOC is good. If you own a house, you can just borrow against your borrow a HELOC, and it will pay all your credit card. That's have a lower interest rate. And then you can borrow a larger amount. Like a personal loan, it only go up so much. But the HELOC, you can literally borrow the entire equity of your home. All right. The other thing I've seen people done is credit card. All right. You know, use the credit card. There's like some that's no fun credit, what do you call it? No interest credit card for like 24 months or something like that. Well, guess what? Tesla is 18 months and will pay it off, you know? So essentially a lot of people, they do is they borrow the money from, or they take the money from the credit card, buy Tesla, and then take all that dividends and pay it back off before they even hit. So people use credit card, and I've seen people do it. I don't like any of those methodology, because the reason I don't like any of this, I'm just not very good. I'm not disciplined and responsible enough to keep paying my credit card that way. You know, I just can't do it. So for me, the P loan is the best one. that's my personal thing. And HELOC, the HELOC, that's only if you have rental, if you have property. If you don't have property, HELOC doesn't really matter. But so P loan, credit card. And to me, that's better than pulling a 403k, your 403b, I believe. I'm sorry. To me, that's just a much better option than that. But if you're gonna pull it, you're gonna pull it. I mean, that's your money. At the end of the day, not all of us here just give our opinions. Here's the thing: do you need to do that for your high yield dividends? My argument would say no. Just be patient. Just be patient. There's no need to rush it. You got all the time in the world. Yeah, you miss out $1.15 and IWMY. You know, it's okay. It's okay. It's not the end of the world. There's no rush. There's no rush to borrow money to do these things. If you want to borrow money, use the margin for opportunity. Like, for example, a good example, my portfolio here. In order for me to get 1,000 share, I only have 7,715. I'm not gonna get 1,000 share. I need $10,000 more. So I can just borrow $10,000 from the margin, and then I'll get 1,000 share. Or I just don't rush it. I don't need to rush it, because I got 7,000. I will get about 500 share here, or 400 or 500 shares. And next month, I make about $4,000 a month. You know, so and next month, I'll take that $4,000. And get more share, and you just there's no rush. I don't see the point of rushing it. It's not what jeopardizing your 403B. Do you all agree or disagree? Let's go back to Dwayne and X and all that stuff. Dwayne?
So, you know, I'm gonna throw this out there. You know, most of us that are doing this type of investing understand that there's risks and have asked ourselves, what's the worst that could happen? Well, the worst that could happen is you could lose your money. But most of us have backup. We've got, this isn't money that we are necessarily dependent on. You know, I've got my stuff separated. So if the absolute worst happened and I lost this money I'm playing with, I'm still covered. I'm just trying to make what I'm going to have better with this money, but I'm not going to risk what I've already got.
Well, I can say that let me try to explain my thought process a little bit, a little background maybe.
All right.
My house, I have very little debt. Like my cars are paid off. I owe $29,000 on my house. I mean, very conservative. You know, I have good job security. And pretty much the only thing I could lose my job is if I commit a crime, especially the way things are going right now in society with being a police officer. My goal is I don't want to work side hustles anymore. That's why I'm like, 34,000, that's how much I would have to borrow. And it's not even, like I said, all it does is it takes it from my investments and I'm paying the interest back to myself. It deducts from my paycheck. I'm not stopping my contributions. I'm still maxed out on my contributions at 866. So that's why I'm kind of like considering it.
Well, none of us here are going to tell you what to do or what not to do. In the end, you got to make that decision for yourself. So everything that anyone says here, you know, just take as with a grain of salt and go from there.
I could give you a couple of like details about that, as I never discuss it because I'm always afraid of like accidentally endorsing what could be a very risky and dangerous behavior. But you know, in your particular case, the math behind what you're doing is going to be very easy to make work, as long as what you said is true. If you don't have any other debt, you don't have any other burden, if the repayment process would be coming out of your paycheck anyway, and you have every intention of continuing your work, look, people do stuff like that all the time. Borrowing for 401k to leverage the money is a common thing, and it's something that from taxation standpoint, they do their damnedest to, you know, to monitor and be careful with. But if you have the means to do it, it's simple math. I mean, there's no real emotional reason to or not to do it. It's just a matter of if you want to put that kind of leverage into play. If it's going back to you, the interest cost is zero. So you're just taking future earnings today that you're going to be making tomorrow. So the math of it works. But I will point something out that I think Kamara kind of sort of hinted at. So without getting into the details, I have a tremendous amount of credit available to me, like a very large from the business side and personally. So I've actually sat, because most of my money is tied up in real estate and I'm a big real estate person, you know, it's not a liquid thing. It's a cash flow thing for me. So, you know, I have a deal coming up in the next 2 months that will free up quite a bit of capital, and that's going to be my play money for the high yield investment. But in order to test the waters beforehand, I tapped into debt. Small amounts, but so that I could start building the portfolio, monitoring the payouts, basically a litmus test so I can get a feel for it. I did the math, checked to see what it would cost versus what it earns, made sure everything lines up, which is why I would go out of my way to say that there is a difference between whether you borrow the money today and put it to work and then use the proceeds to pay down the debt instead of reinvesting into the funds versus taking free and clear money as you earn it and then contributing it. They do have different outputs. The borrow today and pay back is going to outstretch so long as the debt service percentage is not particularly high. And in your case, it's zero. you're going to have a faster timeline with that version. But I did want to point out that not as much faster as you might think. It's better, but not so exorbitantly better unless you're dealing with very large numbers where the difference starts to, pun intended, compound. It's not as dramatic as it might seem. In other words, if you borrow the 35 grand, put it in now, and then pay back the debt service with the proceeds versus week by week taking that money that you would have been paying back to your debt and instead adding it to the fund and letting it drip on itself, that's going to keep pace for smaller denominations pretty well. It'll get bested, but it's not as dramatic as it might seem at first. And the second thing is, absolutely under no circumstance should you be margining these positions while doing something like this, because you could always get called for a margin and forcibly squeezed out of a position. I know it's a little more predictable with a fund, but that's an element of risk that I personally think is above and beyond reasonable with that kind of extra debt service, even if the service is paying to yourself. I do think if you're going to use margin, you should use the margin without having any other debt service tied to it. I do believe it's a little too much double downing. But that's me personally. It does wind up the math, you know.
I wouldn't use margin. I've never done it, and I wouldn't do it. It's just more of a, it's like stopping the growth investing or cutting the growth investing that's going on in my retirement account until I can pay it back. It's just cutting it in half until I can pay it back and doing high yield investing. It's kind of how I get it.
I don't see why not. I mean, as long as you've done the math, it's perfectly reasonable.
Well, I appreciate everyone's opinion. I really do.
That's a really good question. Very good. You know who play with this a lot? If you ever see him, his name is Ruger. He's here. Yeah, Tree Ruger. He play with the borrow money. I think he does personal loan, and he pay it back. He has a really good system, good formula, and I recommend you two sit down and talk about that, and that whole process. I don't do that. The only thing I've done is a margin loan. Now I have used P loan. If you own rental property, you're gonna use P loan a lot, because something always breaks. Whether it's a boiler or an AC system or a heating system, water, whatever it is, and you need cash right away. So you call the contractor, come in, and the guy's gonna say $10,000, you know, whatever. Guess what? You don't have $10,000 in your checking account, so you just borrow this money and you pay the contractor, and he'll install the new, you know, water heating system, and then try to get the money back from the insurance company, you know. So it's just one of the fastest way to do things, you know. X, do you run into that kind of issue with P loan? You take a lot of P loan, or how do you pay for it? Just credit card, or?
You know something? I almost exclusively use cards because they have so much breathing room for our operation. So like, I've never had to take the loans, though I did have a very long conversation with someone about the idea of arbitraging, you know, just how much credit you actually could squeeze out of an established business. P loans, you know, lines of credit for the business itself. There's a plethora of different, you know, tools that you could squeeze.
Yeah.
And as long as the arbitrage is good enough, it could be worth it. I just don't have a need for that. But you're right, with real estate, those things do happen, and that's the easiest way to shore them up temporarily.
Yeah, so that means you have good credit card. At one point, my credit card was always max. So,
the difference is between personal and business funding. You know, business funding doesn't based on a person, an individual's credit. Yeah. So, like, our business lines are multitudes larger than you know my personal card. So, you know, it's all a matter of, you know, the right tool for the job, you know.
Yeah. No, that's a good question. I hope that helped, Marsh. That's pretty good. Good question.
So, if I could jump in real quick, it's Big Lance.
Yeah.
I'm a little bit with on X's side. You know, I come from a lot of real estate too. But maybe I'm the minority. I think we're all here for the high dividend stuff.
Yeah.
But if you, and Kamir, if you remember, I don't know, maybe back in May, June, you were 100% against margin, right? And little by little, you start to see and you realize I am a big, very big believer because I have a lot of real estate. And if you have any investment properties, anybody here who might have it, you're using margin, right? To pay back your debt.
It's just called differently. Yeah, but it's margin. It's margin. They call it differently, you know?
Yeah, yeah. And you're basically on the brokerage account side, you're doing the same thing. You're creating a little bit of debt. But as long as you have the high yield income, the high yield investments that are easily going to pay back that margin plus some, now you've created exactly what everybody else in the world who has an investment property. That investment property, you have a tenant, or think of it like an Airbnb, they're paying your mortgage back, which is the margin. And then what's left over is your profit. And that's what, if you use margin smartly, correctly, you have the right brokerage, you can exponentially create a tremendous amount of wealth for you with very little margin than versus a investment property, an Airbnb. And, you know, I know a lot of people are very scared about it. I think it gets a bad rap. But if you use it responsibly, like Kamir, you are, and a lot of people can, and as long as you have a good rate, you know, I think it's the greatest tool, and I've said this before, but I think it's the greatest cheat code where you can put in 100 grand in your brokerage account and they'll give you, based upon your brokerage, they'll give you a loan off of it, and it doesn't go on your credit report. It's almost instantaneous. And then you can instantaneously invest that. And if you can do it responsibly, just understand the margin requirements where maybe people get frustrated or they don't know. I mean, it's a cheat code. And so that's just my two cents. I think the gentleman who was asking about taking out that loan, I'm a little different. I would say absolutely do it. But again, make sure you're investing in the product that you believe in, that has high enough yield that'll pay back that monthly, you know, nut, so to speak, and just be responsible with it. And you know, loans get people ahead in life, and to have a margin loan where you're not, it's not in your credit, Kamir, right?
Yep.
Like that, I think that's invaluable. So those are my two cents, but you know, X might have, obviously has a little bit of a different thought. But I'm not so much of a fan of, and I know what X is saying, you know, I've got a lot of businesses and you can create a business and you can create business credit. I would use that, me personally, I would use that as a backup to the margin account you get with a brokerage. And that's just me, because you're going to get, depending upon your brokerage, you're going to get 1 or 2 or 3 to 1 based upon what you put into your brokerage. So let's hold off on putting more, you know, credit on your name and on your credit report, and let's just see how it goes on the margin side of things. So there's horror stories. You're not going to lose. Go ahead, X. I'm sorry.
No, I was just going to say, I largely agree with you. My qualm, just to be clear, is not with what you're saying. Is 95% of what you're saying, I'm on board with. The only delineation I was trying to point out, and probably poorly did, is that the association you're making about using margin like a rental property is correct. As a matter of fact, it's exactly how I explained it to someone a few mornings ago. I said, it's not really much different from taking a mortgage against a property and leveraging that debt for cash flow. It's the same concept. I mean, conceptually the same. However, there is a very large difference in the risk analysis you do when it comes to a mortgage and a margin. When you say responsibly use margin, that means different things to different people, and that's where the error comes in. Because my mortgage payment for any one of my many properties, when they come in, that mortgage payment is predictable and slow. And if I don't make that payment, there's a slew of laws to protect me from losing that property. I have plenty of time to correct that problem, and all I've got to do is make it current, and I keep the asset. If the margin call comes in, they have no obligation to stop from selling you out of positions. Now, in theory, that may not make a difference. If you get a margin call for 10 grand and they forcibly sell 10 grand of securities, it may not have particularly hurt you. I've had that happen. I've had an account that got called, they sell out of something. Sometimes I've even had a broker look at an account and sell something, I would argue, half intelligently and go, hey, this is a good place to cut some to make the call. But it's one of the only cases where you leverage debt and they have an instantaneous right to forfeit the asset to cover that debt without even telling you that they're doing it. So that's the thing. You understand probably what it means to be responsible with margin, but that doesn't necessarily mean that most people do. And if you get put in that position and you take a bath on whatever it is that they sell you out of, which with ETF funds, with high yield, I should say, funds, yeah, is likely because of the share price shed, well, then you've been exposed to a little bit of risk that maybe the ordinary person isn't really thinking through or used to. That's my only, you know, pet peeve, if you will, about letting people just run wild with margin.
and you know what? I agree when you say it like that. It does, you know, from what I know and what I'm doing, it sounds scary, but it's just like anything. If you're driving your car, you have a speedometer, you have an oil gauge, same thing on your brokerage account. You know how much margin you're using. Like, it's not just like they're just going to call you up one day and say, hey, give me all your money. There's levels, there's numbers that say, hey, this is how much you have until you have a margin call. And even if there is a margin call, it's not like you're losing all of your money. Like, let's make sure everybody understands that. It's just, you might have to sell a position one or two. But if you use less than half of your margin, the entire world has to collapse for you to actually have a margin call. That's how low you can go on your margin if you use it responsibly. Right. So X, see, I know you
there,
would you agree
there's
with
the trick is that you have more faith in people than I do.
I mean, but for all intents and purposes, do you agree with that or
yes,
you,
yeah,
no, no. Okay.
100% on board with what you're saying. My pointing out the delineation and the difference is simply out of habit. I mean, having worked in the financial world in the past and just in business in general, I have very little confidence in, you know, the end user's ability to do what they're supposed to do. And I don't mean that to be negative overly, but the truth of the matter is I would not trust most people to intelligently read that dashboard and make intelligent decisions even on their own behest. It's not to say that no one
can.
That's
true. I get it.
But,
yeah,
you know, like, call me crazy, but I've seen people do insane things.
I get it. You listen, we always, as professionals, you prepare for the worst case scenario. So I totally understand. So, and come here, I'm proud of you for dipping into the margin pool, by the way.
Oh, yeah. No, I did it for experiments. I knew all the, if I sell everything, I knew I would get a positive number back. So, because I did it just to experiment. So here's my margin. It was I dipped $20,000. So think about that. I was just buying everything. The only one that I actually lose in margin, if I every time buy Tesla and Clip and with my margin, I'm not selling them. So therefore it's in here. So it's stuck in here. So that's with a negative number. But if I buy like Tesla and all the other one that I'm going to sell later on. Guess what? That money's in here. And guess what I made? I made the difference is here, you know, when I bought it. So I bought, like, let's say it's, if I sell so far right now, this is all bottom margin. If I sell right now, I would make $126. Okay.
By the way, did you buy all of the, I missed it. Maybe you posted the video. I know you sold everything last night. Did you buy everything up today? Maybe
No, tomorrow. Sorry. Tomorrow. I can't buy it until tomorrow. So here's the decision point for me. I want to own 1,000 share of QQY. I have 7,715. So number one, if I sell my Tesla, my SoFi, that will go up to $11,000. Still, that's not 1,800. So that means I have to borrow. I don't have to borrow 1,800 because I'm going to get paid by Tesla here in 2 weeks, and I'm going to get paid here. So I may have to borrow 5,000 for margin to get to 1,000 share. So that's one COA, or I just don't buy anything at all and just get 500 share, and next month in January I will get I will just fill it up with 500 share because it's not. I just need one more month to fill it up, you know. So yeah, I may not be able to buy 1,000 share here without using margin. But
what's your rate on margin with Charles Schwab? Is that like 12%?
Oh, I don't tell you the truth. I never calculated. I think on the brochure it's like 11%. I don't know what my is, but that's what the advertising number is.
So generally, if you've got over at least 50,000, do you have 50,000 of your account?
My margin is it's 100,000 now.
No, dude. What's your base amount? So if you have your net asset value,
you can watch 50? It. It's on the screen. Just click on the live. You can see it.
I'm sorry, I'm driving. I apologize.
Oh, you're driving? My base amount is 76,000.
So you should give them a call. Yeah. You could call them and tell them, listen, you plan on using margin, and you can actually negotiate that rate down. Usually, if you're over 50,000,
yeah.
And I did this with Fidelity probably 6 months ago before I switched to Interactive Brokers. You can negotiate it down. Fidelity took me from 12% to like 8%.
Oh wow!
In terms of the interest rate, so. You can just, you call them, you tell them, listen, you know, you're using margin, you've been using it, you're hesitant. Are you guys willing to reduce my rate here as I'm going to be using it more and more? And generally, if you've got at least over 50,000 in the account, they're willing to work with you. And you think about it, you know, and X will probably tell you this, it's one phone call and you could save 2-4%. And you know, just with that phone call, it's definitely worth its weight in gold.
Okay.
That is 100% accurate.
Yeah. I'll take a look at it. I don't like the way how Charles Schwab do the margin. I like the way in Interactive Broker do. Oh, which one is the one that Brandon use? Whatever the company he used.
Brandon's with M1.
M1? I like that. I like that method. It's separate. It's like you actually borrow a line of credit from them.
Charles Schwab does it like a loan.
Yeah, Charles Schwab does not treat it like that. Charles Schwab, so if I borrow $20,000, every dividends, any positive money, didn't matter, I put money in it or dividends or interest, didn't matter, any positive money, it take out of the margin. It's stupid. I want to be able to separate it and let me pay. Let me decide when to pay. But they don't do that. Yeah, so essentially, like if I have a margin, if I have a negative margin right now, let's say I doesn't matter what number is. When I get paid by Tesla on the 18th, that I won't see that money. I will not see that money because it goes right directly to the margin and paid it. And reduce that margin.
But you could still buy things. So that's the difference. Like
I can always buy things.
But it's a total for the margin account. It's a total philosophy difference, right?
Yeah.
Like if you borrowed $20,000 to buy Tesla,
yep.
And in 3 months, if that $20,000 is paid back,
yep.
That's not like a credit card bill. It's like a mortgage, like, right?
So now you own 20,000 worth of share.
So to yourself.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, but it's not like money that is just in the wind.
Yeah.
So it's a totally different philosophy if you're gonna start using.
You're coming broken now.
You know, sorry, I'm driving. I'm driving. I apologize.
Yeah, no, it's okay. Why don't we come back to you, because you may hit a no 3G spot. Dwayne, can you want to say something?
Yeah, so I debated on whether or not I was going to bring this up or not, but since it's on subject, I mentioned to you not too long ago, I did something that's going to tie up my dividends for a little bit.
Yeah.
When Tesla was down around the 200 mark, I used about a quarter of my margin to buy up some Tesla. And so I'm just sitting on that, waiting for Tesla to get back up to a range that I want to sell it at. And I'm gonna sell off enough to pay off the margin and then pocket the rest of the Tesla shares.
Tesla or Tesla?
Tesla.
Oh wow. That's something I don't dare to do.
I bought 90 shares of Tesla. Let's say I've got probably a 206 average.
Yeah.
You know, and up right now, currently I'm about $3,000 up on it.
So wow, that's good.
My plan is sometime in the next month or 2 months or, you know.
You're not worried that Tesla may go down, continue to go down?
Of course I'm worried about that. and that's why I use, you know, a quarter of my margin.
Yeah.
Anytime I hear someone, oh, I've maxed out my margin, it makes my back teeth hurt.
Yeah.
You know, for me gritting. And you know, I'm very anti-debt. And so this is just, it's a gamble that I decided to take because I do believe that Tesla, you know, with the Cybertruck rollout and a few other things going on
let's take a look at it real quickly. Let's see what Tesla price is and aftermarket here after the, oh shoot, 235.
So, you know, which, you know, it was teasing up at 250 earlier yesterday.
Yeah, it hit.
Which, what I said is to myself is I'll sell it at least 250, but I'm going to try to hold out to at least 270 is what I'd like to see. Of course, if it has a nice run to 300, that'd be nice because then I get to keep that many more paying after.
No, it's good. And, you know, so here's my problem is this. This is why I don't like it. So negative, let's say this number is negative 7,000, okay? Right now it's positive 7,000, but let's say it's negative 7,000. Negative 7,000. So when Tesla pay me $2,000, it's going to take this number to 5,000 because it's trying to bring it back to zero. So
it's the same way.
Yeah, so... But I don't like that because what happened, but you can still buy it. So let's say I want to spend $2,000. Tesla give me $2,000, I want to spend that $2,000. Well, this number is going to remain the same. It's 7,000, negative 7,000. It's going to be, you know, it's going to come down to negative 5. As soon as I spend something, $2,000 worth, it's going to go back to negative 7,000. So that's essentially what margin is in Charles Schwab. I don't like that method. I'm not used to it. I definitely don't like it. And that's the part. I'm sorry, go ahead, Dwayne.
Yeah, I mean, the way I look at it, because I'm in the same thing, you know, where.
Yeah, Charles Schwab,
you know,
too.
My dividends go. I'm not in Charles Schwab. Oh. No, I'm in Vanguard and Webull. Mm-hmm. But, you know, all my dividends are going to repay that debt. So, you know, currently I've got $2,500 a month going to repay that. So that when I do sell it, that's that much more that'll be stocked away.
You know, okay.
Margin loan will be paid off partially by the time I get
it. Yeah. No, I, well, now I have like almost $100,000 worth of margin. So it's pretty cool. You know, I have a lot of margin now, but I'm not planning. I think I'm going to stay away from margin for 2024 because I like the idea that here it is. Clip's going to pay me $1,000. Okay. Today or tomorrow, or Monday. Clip's always late. I have never seen Clip pay on time. To Charles Schwab, they pay on time to Fidelity, but never pay on time for me. So I'm gonna get $1,000 from Clip, and then And then on the first, QQY is going to pay me, what, $100. And on Tesla, he's going to pay me $2,000. So there's $3,000 right there, you know, and some change that, you know, for the month of December that I can use to do something else, whatever I want to do. And I like that feeling. I love the feeling of receiving that money. So I'm going to, that's why I stopped, I'm going to stop doing it. And what I can do is I can take that $3,000 and buy more QQY for January, you know, so I can just do that. And, but I'm going to, yeah, it's just different way of doing things, you know, but you have to get used to it. Big Lance, you back? Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah. Why not take that $25,000 and put it all into QQQY?
I don't have $25,000. You mean the margin?
Well, your margin, yeah. Yeah, and your margin.
Well, my margin is like $100,000.
Right, so take a quarter of it. Oh. Right, X, be responsible with it.
Yeah.
Take a quarter of it. That $25,000 is free money.
Yeah.
Right? $25,000 in the QQQY.
And then get my
You'll make $1,500 a month off of that $25,000, and your interest rate's probably $500, maybe. I don't know what it is. And so it's basically a free $1,000 that you're making every single month. And then that'll be paid off. And, you know, you could sell it at any time, but it's, you know, the difference between your interest rate and what that product will provide you, you know, is obviously your net profit.
Here's what I don't like about it. So let's say Tesla priced. So I bought, spent $25,000 on QQY. I got my money. But let's say Tesla, for example, on the 3rd or 4th here of December, the Tesla price, let's say they pay $1 dividends. Now this thing dropped to 1067. I'd be like, great, 1067, I'm going to buy it. Guess what? That means I have to increase that margin again because I, any dividends I have, it will go right into that margin. It's just kind of crazy logic. It's hard to explain it. I just don't like that feeling. It's not logic. It's just feeling that I don't like that feeling. Like,
no, I get it. I totally get it. I get it for sure. I understand.
But if this thing dropped to 1067, I have 3,000 here. Guess what? I spent 3,000. I'll be like, yay. That's my money, you know?
Yeah.
Myself, I don't like these high dividend yield funds, in margin. Myself, I'm only doing this with Tesla because I think I can make a short-term large gain by using it. And my goal is to be out of that margin debt in like 3 months.
So mathematically, though, the only reason why I like the margin with these high yields is because no matter what happens, as long as the high yields keep paying the high yields that they're paying, the margin, no matter what happens, will be paid off in 2 years, 2.5 years. And then even if you know, like Coney, if the price goes up, now I'm getting, you know, 60% yield plus that appreciation. So, I mean, maybe X, I don't know if he's still on because I'm driving, but X, what are your thoughts on that? I mean, that's how I look at it. As you know, you guys know it's a rental property, but you know, as long as the fund keeps paying these yields, I mean, I'm good. And it only works, the margin only works with these high yields. It doesn't work with QYLD. It doesn't work with SPYI. It only works with these yield max funds and that sort of stuff. What are your thoughts, X?
You're not wrong. You know, that is true. But I would be remiss if I didn't point out that, you know, there is risk there. I'm not saying that your math is sound, but there is risk. You have to be comfortable with that risk. The chances of one of these high yield funds not paying their dividend is very, very low, but it's not zero. And if they don't pay out, you get stuck with the margin bill. If you take a fund that's paying you 30% yield, let's say, and your margin interest is 11%, it's logical to look at that and say, well, there's a arbitrage situation here. There's a 19% spread. If I just keep this for a year, I should make 19% on the money. But that isn't actually correct. It's not even close to correct. Because the money that comes into you is taxable income, in theory. I mean, if it's not in a tax-deferred, you know, Roth account or whatever the situation may be. But in a normal brokerage account, it's taxable income. So you have to factor that in. The second thing is, margin's a double-edged, you know, blade. It's great for the proceed side of it, but it's horrific for the depreciation side. As your share value diminishes, the margin balance is not. If you buy something and it's $10 a share, next year it's $7 a share, you still owe the $3. You need to have collected the commensurate amount of income from that fund for that not to be a significant loss. And I agree with you, likelihood is very high. I think for someone who's competent, watches their margin, keeps watching the funds to make sure they're catching wind of a bad change and then adjusts accordingly, probably a very prudent play. But for a person that's not going to do those things, there are hidden, you know, there are hidden risks there. It's not as simple as saying, well, the output's higher in this one, so I must make money. That's not exactly true. So it really depends on the end user. In your case, Lance, probably a smart play. In other people's cases, yeah, I'd have to go on a case-to-case basis because, you know, the funds will depreciate in value. Like, there's no version of reality where that doesn't happen over a long enough time horizon.
And so, just so the audience knows, you can also mitigate your margin risk by...
Big Lance, you're coming broken. No, this is a very good, interesting topic, because this come up a lot in high yield dividends, because you can't, if you try to do this with Coca-Cola, SCHD, you're going to fail because, well, maybe not. I don't know. I never try it. But because the yield is just too low. It's just too low. You can't pay it off, because if you borrow $20,000, you're paying essentially almost $500 worth of interest. And so you just don't generate enough income from it. All these high yield dividends, they generate so much income from it that essentially you're borrowing 10%, you know, but you're making 60%, you know, so you're profiting like almost 50% of yield, you know. So that's just in translation, you know, loss of, so there's opportunity to make money. You can literally borrow, you know, I probably can borrow like $50,000. That's half of the $100,000, and take that $50,000 and buy QQY, Clip, or Tesla. Oh, let's say Tesla, a good example. It's only $11.67, but I will get that. I will get a whole bunch of share. The only thing I don't like about that, if that margin, that dollar amount, that $50,000, is only taken out from Tesla, I'd be so happy. I don't mind jamming Tesla for $50,000 for the next 10 months. For the next 10 months, I will never see Tesla pay dividends, because every time I get $2,000 paying that margin of $50,000 for the next 10 months or whatever the number of months is, I don't have any problem with that. But the problem is, it take all my money. It didn't matter what it is. My contribution, my $1,000 I put for my check, it take that to pay Tesla. QQY, it take that to pay Tesla. Clip money, it take pay that to pay Tesla. And then my interest, it take that to pay Tesla. My Christmas money, it take to pay Tesla. It didn't matter what I put. As long as I put money in the Charles Schwab, it take that money to pay Tesla. I don't like that. I don't want to pay the margin. $2,000 a month from Tesla is good enough. It's more than enough to pay the interest. And but yet they want to take all the money to pay it all at once. You know, I don't like that mechanism at all. I want that $2,000 to pay the $50,000 margin. Just pay it. And then the Clip money and the QQY money, in my case, will, you know, to buy something else. I want to buy something else. but I can't buy something else because all my money is going to pay the Tesla margin. You see what I'm talking about? All right. No, a very interesting subject. One last subject here, and then it's 9 o'clock. I'm sorry.
I just had a quick question. You know, we talked about reinvesting the dividends or using the dividends to pay off debt, whether that's margin, credit cards, or what have you. What I haven't heard is, what are people's strategies in regards to using the distributions, the dividends, for living expenses or, you know, just personal things you want outside of reinvesting and the debt and the taxes? Like, I haven't heard anyone saying, like, yeah, I'm using $1,000 for this, but I'm also using, you know, I'm putting $1,000 away to spend every month. So is anybody actually doing that yet?
Yeah, there's a lot of people. You can talk to, there's a lot of people. You can talk to Matt. You can talk to Joanna. Maury. Maury's right here. Maury. You can talk to Brian. They all retired. None of them work. Oh, I mean, Maury doesn't.
Like I said, I was just kind of curious of, you know, how they were approaching that, because, you know, the vast majority of the conversation, it seems like people are in the, you know, they're just gathering everything up stage.
Yeah. Maury, are you there? Can you chime in as a retiree, as a somebody who retired? Is Maury there? All right, so, yeah, so Maury, like a lot of you, we have a lot of retiree in here, and you just ask the same question in the written Discord, in the general Discord. Some, you know, like Brian can jump in. I know Brian's Brian, Matt, and Joanne, and all these guys, Maury. So what they take the money and they spend it, or they take the money and they do something else, you know. I mean, that's essentially it. They take the money and spend it.
Okay, so it's just kind of, I don't know, like you said, I haven't heard anyone.
Yeah, there's no penalty.
I just haven't heard the stories on YouTube or you know, just anything in general, people actually using it for other than just reinvesting or dividends or debt or tax. Yeah. So it's just something I hear about a lot.
Yeah, so Texas Heat, to answer this question, the mechanic of it, I actually test this out. So all you do is go to, in Charles Schwab, I don't know about your fund, for us, it go transfer money, because what happened is, like if you look at, I don't know, you can see my screen. You see how this hit 7,000 right now?
Yeah.
That's positive money, 7,000. That's and sitting in the money market. So if I do nothing at all, that as long as I have 7,000 there, it's collecting like a daily interest rate that paid me monthly. I forgot the money market for Charles Schwab is like 4%.
Yeah.
So if I keep this for a month, I get 4% daily time, you know, and then at the end of the month, it will pay me money. But let's say I want to withdraw this money. All I do is go transfer money from my Charles Schwab to my bank.
Yeah, and I understand all that. But like I said, my question was just if anybody had any strategy that they were implementing where, you know, people have stated that these high yield ETFs only work or work the best by reinvesting the dividend, and I didn't know what people are saying. You know, what can you limit that to? Like, is it still, do people are still confident in it at a 50% drip, 25% drip, you know, 25% taxes? You know, just I was kind of curious what people's strategies
were. That's actually a really good question. And if you watch the interview that Jay did recently, you know, he even mentions using the drip as a percentage to shore up the share price. Basically, the question you're asking, you can kind of estimate for yourself. I don't know if anyone's ever spoken in the group about what percentage they use, but if you look at a year return chart using Tesla as an example, you know, if you just map out what the shed on share price is, then you just have to replenish that amount to maintain the status quo percentage-wise. I would bet you, honestly, it's probably somewhere in the half mark. I've never done the actual math, but if I sat and looked at it, maybe I can give you a more accurate number. Maybe I'll screw with that, around with it tomorrow if you're around. I'll see if I can give you the math behind it. But it's probably somewhere in that realm, because you're right. You know, if you're going to live off the money that's coming out of the fund, you need a certain amount of money to go back into the fund to make sure that the fund's correlative value stays the same. Otherwise, your output from the dividend is going to shrink through time.
Yeah.
Now, you know, from an investment standpoint, if the timeline is long enough, it doesn't matter if the share per share is shrinking. But in your case, when you're talking about living off of it, you know, it very much matters. It matters that the output is the same and predictably so. So I'll do a little bit of experimenting. Maybe I'll post the math and we can kind of like go over it and discuss it. But I'm going to bet it's somewhere in that realm, given a 40 to 50% yield for these high yielders. I would assume that like a half of that would probably keep the share price stable, you know?
Yeah, that was the feeling that I got was, you know, kind of a 50% reinvest, a 25% for taxes, and a 25% for, you know, spending it how you want. I kind of had a feeling that that would be maybe doable, but I was just curious if anyone had strategies on it.
In most cases, you're probably pretty spot on. I would think the other thing you're going to see is that it's very much a tax sensitive issue. So depending on your particular, since it is income, you know, that's going to drastically change. You know, someone all the way at the high end of the bracket is going to be paying substantially more taxes. And that becomes a much bigger part of the equation over a long period of time. So their strategies are obviously going to be different on a person to person basis because of that.
Yeah. All right. Like I said, that was my question. I was just kind of curious.
So my strategy, I'll let you know in 2 years, but I'm going to withdraw all the money. And I have a separate tax plan. So that's coming from a different source of income. That pay for all my taxes. And so now if, let's say I don't have that and assume I don't have that, what I will do is I'm withdrawing all that money. And since I don't have a W-2 form or something like that, I would just put that money aside. Like I'll give you an example. I can't click on here. I have a fund. It's a single fund. I have another account. It's a single fund Tesla fund. I only buy Tesla. So what happened is that once I go into $10,000 and I no longer have a job, I'm not paying into a W-2. There's three ways you can pay tax. You can pay tax through W-2 form. Or you can send a check directly to iOS and you just pay the iOS. Mm-hmm. Or you can have whatever your source of income, this is a source of income, get these company here, in my case, Charles Schwab, to take the money out automatically and pay it into the iOS. So that's one way to do it, sell Charles Schwab to take the money automatically out. Or you can do it the way I do it, is I want to control that money, so I open another account and it essentially is Tesla. I only buy Tesla. I'm taking all that money and put into Tesla. So it's generating, it's dividend reinvestment. So what happened when I filed a tax here in February, I don't do it. I mean, my tax people do it. So when they file the tax, they say, hey, you owe, you know, $80,000, $90,000. Well, I'm going to sell all that position out of Tesla. I'm going to sell everything. and that's the money I'm going to use to pay for it, you know. So that's one way to pay for it, is to sell all that and pay for it. Or the second method is I say, okay, well, just send me a check and I'll write a check for it and I just pay for that way. Or I can say, can I get paid a monthly installment for the next 2 years, you know? And then I just pay the monthly installment on that for the next 2 years. So there are many ways to pay for it. But essentially I have it sitting in a fund. So I don't know why. Initially I buy the SGOV fund. They give me, you know, this one right here. So $100, it's a bond fund. It gave me, you know, 42 cents dividends. That's where I put my tax money that I'm going to pay into this fund. And then when Tesla was priced was so low at $10, I said, oh, well, screw these guys. I'm going to take that and buy Tesla because any price after $10 is going to be positive money that I sell. So I take that money and buy Tesla. And so when I need to sell it, let's say that $14, $15 in February or March or whenever I need to sell it, let's hope it's not $9, but if it's $10 or more, guess what? I will make some capital from that. And also I got some interest from putting money in Tesla. And then I just sell the whole thing and I use that and pay the tax. So that's my method. One of the method, you know. Currently, because I have a job, my method of paying tax right now is W-2. So essentially, out of my $10,000 of paycheck I get, almost 40% of that money is in going to W in tax. So essentially, I'm putting $44,000 a month times 12. So I'm putting $48,000 a month times 12. And here's the sad news about my tax situation. I still pay taxes. I put $48,000 a month into taxes and I still pay taxes. So it is what it is. There's not much I can do about it. I put a W-2 because I have a paycheck right now. Joanna just joined in. Let's ask Joanna. Hey, Joanna, you there? Can you hear us?
Hi, I can hear you.
Yeah, so Texas Heat have a question about people who's going to be retired or retire ready. How are they going to spend their money? How what's your plan to spend your money? Oh, you know what? I'll let Texas Heat ask the question.
Yeah, my question was just someone's strategy who's actually taking the distribution and the dividend and doing something other than paying debt with it, paying taxes with it, or reinvesting it. All I've heard are people who are doing those three things. I haven't really heard of anyone who's getting a large distribution and how they're utilizing that for their own pleasure, for living, or anything like that.
Well, you know, income investing is not new. So I think there's probably a lot of people out there that have been living off their income for quite some time. And I do know some. I'm treating it like a paycheck. So with these funds, I think you have to take some time to see where the highs and lows are. So I posted something the other day, just questions for people to think about that are nearing retirement. You really need to carefully run your numbers. So you have to, what I'm doing is I'm going line by line in my budget. I'm a planner anyways, so I write everything out. Like how much, what are your expenses? And then you have to plan for reinvesting a portion of that. And you also have to look at what is the lowest amount that you can live on. So with all of these distributions, they fluctuate. Like today, Jeppy's only paying 65 cents. So that's one of the reasons why I have a blended portfolio. I don't want all the high yield funds, and I'm going to end up selling some of them because I've been investing in income for a couple of years now. So there's ones that are paying me that I'm not going to put any more money into. But I wouldn't feel comfortable myself having any less than like 20 funds because I have bank funds, I have energy funds, I have the high yield funds, I've got all the Defiance, I've got most of the Yield Max in different weights. And you don't necessarily need to do that, but you need to plan for, okay, what is the lowest amount that this is going to bring me and what's the highest amount, and plan to live on the lowest. So like, I would say that I'm planning for around at least $9,000 a month. And out of that is going to come tax. And then how much you need to live, how much you want to reinvest. So I just, like I said, I'm just going to treat it like a paycheck, if that makes sense.
Yeah, that's fair enough. And that's kind of how I would approach it too, is just kind of looking at it from a budget mindset where, you know, this is what I made, and then breaking that down to what takes priority when it comes to taxes and living and reinvesting. And like I said, it sounds like a lot of people are, you know, they're kind of set on reinvesting into the same high yield funds. But it sounded like kind of like you, and what I like too is to kind of diverse that a bit more.
Yeah. So it depends on how long you have to go until you plan to retire. Like if I was going to work another year or two, I'd be more in on the high yield funds, but I don't want huge swings in my income. So the problem with people doing like, oh, I'm going to buy all kinds of QQY, JPY, whatever, that's fine. But then you have to realize that what you might have planned for is not going to happen. So then what happens is if you don't have other funds, like I have like CLM and CRF and SVOL and some other stuff to balance out, then you're going to have very high income months and you're going to have very low income months. Right.
Gotcha. So yeah, I'm on the same thought train on that as well.
Yeah. So what I'm kind of doing is I'm going month by month right now, because technically if I wanted to retire, I could, but I'm looking at, okay, you need to have a buffer. You need to have, like, let's say your expenses are $5,000 a month, and then you should have at least 500 or 1,000 for a buffer, and it's going to vary, but you know what I mean? You have to think of these categories, and then you should have at least 10% somewhere to reinvest. So it works out fine as long as you've planned adequately and that you're realistic and you, again, you go with the low months, don't go for the high months. Cause I see people making comments sometimes, not just in our Discord, but in other ones where they're like, oh, you know, I was expecting 90 cents and it only paid 70. Well, yeah, that's what's gonna happen. So
yeah,
you're not working.
That was my worry. I haven't really heard of it happening yet, but I kind of just imagine something, you know, going all in on, you know, Tesla, and then they're like, okay, I'm making $10,000 a month, and they just think they're done. You know, they don't put any more thought into it. They just, you know, they're taking the money and, you know, I'd be too concerned about what the fund's going to do on the long term and how that's going to affect you and all that stuff.
Well, I think there's always going to be new funds. I'm not really that concerned about these funds long term because I've been doing this long enough that, you know, there's always going to be new funds. Every week now they're coming out with something. So that doesn't concern me because I don't see this going away, because income investing and options is not going to go anywhere. So that doesn't bother me at all. I think that they'll be around for a long time.
Yeah,
but you still have to be strategic into what you're investing in. And like for taxes, people need to realize that depending on which account it's coming from and how many accounts you have, well, you're gonna, when you make those withdrawals, like for me, I'm in a 30% tax bracket. I'm not really saving much money not working. So I think people forget that whatever you think you have in those accounts, you need to make sure you've got tax money.
Yeah.
Because you're gonna have to pay it one way or the other.
Do you happen to take any of your income high yield distributions and reinvest those for dividend growth for long-term purposes?
No, not right now. I sold all my growth funds at the end of 2021 when the market was tanking, and I went all into income because I wanted the cash flow.
Gotcha.
So I sold Microsoft, Amazon, Google, all the good ones. And then I liked them, and I liked
not growth, dividend growth.
No.
Okay.
No, because if I'm going to do that, I'm not really interested in dividend growth funds at all. I want my cash flow. I want the money every month that I can then decide where it's going to go. A dividend growth, there's nothing wrong with it, but I've done that too. Like, and that just doesn't really interest me. I want my cash. Then I can decide where I'm going to put it. And if I was going to invest in growth, it's going to be growth like Microsoft. So I'm going to buy probably some Microsoft and stick it in one of my retirement accounts and just leave it there. Because it'll just grow. But dividend growth doesn't really, for me, it's either growth, like Microsoft, Google, Amazon, or it's the income funds where I have the cash.
Okay, yeah, see, I'm coming from a more of a dividend growth perspective where, you know, just over the course of 20, 30, 40 years, we all know that can grow quite large. But like, I understand your strategy as well with just the high income. You know, you're able to just reallocate that, you know, as you need to meet your cash flow goal. And that's understandable too.
Yeah, I mean, there's not, whatever works for you is fine. There's nothing wrong with dividend growth, but I, knowing how this works and how well it works, I prefer to have my money. I want my cash because I can invest in growth or dividend growth or whatever, but you have that money instead of sitting there and you have unrealized gains. You don't know really what's going to happen. And that's the reason why I switched everything to income. I don't want to have to depend on the market. And if I didn't want to check my portfolio for 2 months, I would still have money coming in. So it's whatever really works for you. But I just prefer to have that money because then I can decide what I'm going to do with it.
Yeah, that's awesome. I appreciate you kind of sharing your strategy.
You're welcome. Did you have any other questions?
No, that's all I really had.
Okay. So yeah, I would say for everyone, as you're getting closer, make sure you sit down, run your budget, like go line by line, plan for all of these things, take your time with it. And once you start to reach your income, you should, I think, go at least 6 months beyond that. That's why I'm still working. I don't really know when I'll stop for sure, but you shouldn't just say, oh yeah, great, I reached $10,000 a month, I'm gonna stop now. Right, because you want to be setting yourself up for success.
Yeah, that's awesome. Jack, do you want to say something? You can unmute your mic.
Hey, yes, come here. Texas, one thing that you need to look into is taxes when you retire change dramatically. I used to live in North Carolina, made a good salary, but paid a fortune in federal, state, and of course, Social Security tax. Now that I've been retired for 2 years and moved to Florida, I only pay federal tax on the money that I'm going to withdraw out of a retirement account. And I just turned 59 and a half in October. So I just started drawing that out. Just like Joanna said, you have to plan, make sure you have a buffer in there. So my plan is to have, you know, take out $8,000 a month for living expenses, but have $16,000 a month in dividend income. So if that fluctuates at all, and of course I plan to reinvest as much as I can each month, but a great website to look at is smartasset.com, and there's a whole bunch of calculators on there, but one of them is a retirement tax calculator. And if you put that in, like I'll tell you, the $8,000 a month, $96,000 a year, the federal tax that I'm going to pay is less than $8,000. That's, you know, nothing compared to what I paid working, making, you know, a big salary in North Carolina. So it changes dramatically in retirement. Just wanted to say that. Thanks.
No, appreciate it. All right, so last question here. This is a tough one. Let's see if anybody want to tackle this answer. So one of the most common question people ask me, because they look at my portfolio, you got Tesla $11.67, and I'm going to buy QQY. So the first question they ask is like, why are you not buying TSLY $11.67, and why are you buying QQY? So instead, you know, so that's this question, because what imply is that which is a better fund, QQY paying a dollar something, but it's $18, or Tesla paying 58 cents, and it's but it's $11.67. I don't know what the implication, what's the difference is. I don't know how you answer this question, because I just do it as personal preference. Like at some point, I gotta stop buying Tesla because I want my payments to be received once a week. The only way I can get my payment to receive once a week, I have to buy something else. So no matter how much I love Tesla, I gotta stop buying it because I gotta buy the other week, you know, like the first week, the second week, the third week, and the fourth week. So if I just keep spending all my money and buy only Tesla, it'd be great, but that's not gonna be achieving my goal. My goal is to get once a week paycheck. So regardless how much this thing is, so at some point I gotta make that decision. So like, so that's one of the things. I'm just curious, if you guys have a choice, which one you rather buy, rather own, QQY or Tesla, and I want to know why. What's your opinion on that?
For me, Kamar, it's a different risk profile.
Yeah.
I mean, QQQY is a very different animal from Tesla, from a share price perspective, a risk profile perspective. It's based off an indices output, so it doesn't have that single holding risk.
Yep.
And it's probably, because of the nature of the way they play options against it, going to preserve share price better. I think Tesla has mathematical attributes that make it sexy, if you will. You know, it's a small share price, so the, you know, compounding effect is going to be quite large. As it sheds price proportionately, you're going to gain more of it as you're dripping. So there's a lot of math behind it, but I think those are two different things in my mind. So I own both of them now, and I'll probably have a large position in both of them through time for that reason.
What's everybody else's plan? If you have a choice between Tesla and QQY, what would you pick? All right, so I could just sit here and wait until somebody ready to answer, but you know, for I'm sorry, go ahead.
So my answer would be to keep buying Tesla because it's low, and then when I get enough to put more in QQY, I mean, you know, because I just think it makes sense.
What you're saying is very logical. Matter of fact, I have no idea why would we want to buy anything other than Tesla, because it's $11.67 and it's paying 70% yield, and you're getting 58 cents or 50 more cents, you know, to a dollar. So it's really good deal. You just can't beat it. It's not a. Does anybody else want to jump in before I just start saying it?
Just comment on. You mind? I don't look at it that way, and I understand for some people just going all in Tesla, depending on what their account size is, how old they are, what their goals are, to go in all in for a short time makes sense. But just to buy something because of the price, I think that to have at some point to have some safety in your portfolio, it's not a very good idea just to buy because of the price, especially with all the choices that we have with these high yield funds. And I just say that investing in various income funds for the last 2 years, at some point, you don't want to have all your eggs in one basket. Like, it shouldn't be just the price, if that makes sense. It's a mix that's in your portfolio that has to, at some point, you need to look at that, especially if you're planning to live on this income.
Yeah, I agree. I totally agree. Lions, go ahead, Lion.
Yeah, I want to add a comment on that. I think this is a good strategy when you go through and doing this as a hybrid approach. So basically, you diversify to another fund, and that way you are basically spread your risk. That's number one. And number two, when you look at the X date, when the share price drops, but the amount of the dividend, that is an opportunity for you to increase your holding and share count at that time. So this is opportunity to basically grow your holding. And so you do basically capital allocation. You take X percentage of your allocation, put it in one, and then based on the timing of the X dividend, you can basically purchase more from the other fund, so that way you grow the dividend and create another snowball.
And yeah.
So that's kind of the hybrid approach. I would take that as a strategy, my opinion.
Yeah. So this is my answer. I don't think there's ever going to be a right answer. It's all up to you, your preference, your risk tolerance, and your timeline. Which one is the better of the two funds? In my opinion, is Tesla, just because it's just been doing exactly what it's supposed to do, which is give me income. And so, and I and I able to buy a lot of Tesla because of the price is so low. I'm able to buy a lot of shares, and it just generate my income just double from what is positioned. So it did its purpose. I do like QQY for the very fact that it's index based, and you know, see, but the reason why I don't like it because it's index based also, because Tesla for option trading purpose, you know, you're making a lot of premium, and that volatility is what give it the dividends. Right now, QQY is too early. This is QQY is showing exactly what Tesla is going through the first 3-4 months. High paying yield, high paying dividends, you know, the first 2-3 months. But once it get into a steady state, once the fund get into $700 million, $500 million, right now QQYs only have $200 million. But once it go into like, you know, 750,000, I'm just curious, will it act the same way as Tesla? Will we look at QQY at $11, $12 also? I don't know, but it's history about to repeat itself right now. So as a result, you know, from that reason. Now for me, I told you, regardless what the price is, I got to go back to my plan, my original plan. Before I do investment, I built a PowerPoint, I figured out what my plan is. I want to get paid monthly, and I want to get up to $5,000. So when you do it that method, then it's agnostics to the price. So it doesn't really matter what the price is, because I got to get $1,000 from the first week. So if this thing could have been $50, well, I would go find something else that's cheaper. But let's say this is the cheapest, let's say $25, the cheapest fund available on the first week. Guess what? That's the fund I'm buying. That's the fund I'm buying because it's the only one. Let's say Chuppie is the only one paying the first week, and it's $50 a month, $50 a share. Guess what? I don't have a choice because it's the only one paying the first week. Even though Tesla is dirt cheap and it's better to own dirt, it's just my preference. I don't want to get paid once a month. I do not want to get paid once a month. If I have to get paid once a month, I will close this account. I literally will close this account. I take my money and do something else. You know? Because I just don't like that idea. I'd rather not do it at all. So that's just my take on it. And so that's how allergic I am to getting paid once a month. I'm so reactive to it that I'd rather close the account than to put all my money into YieldMax, because they all paid once a month. See, this is why when I was having this conversation with the Rexshare guys, they didn't understand it. I told them, I said, look, I'm just one of the thousands of people out there invest. If you're going to retire, I don't want to get paid once a month. And if you're going to force me to pay once a month, I will never buy your share. I will never buy it, because I already have. If you put Rexshare at the same pay time period as Tesla, I can promise you I will never buy Rexshare, because I already own Tesla. And so for whatever reason, if I'm forced to pay Rexshare, I'd rather just close it. I'll take the money and go buy something else. I'll go buy coin, go buy comic books and sell it, and, you know, go buy gold, make money. You know, it's not important. What's important to me is the psychological. For me, I'm retiring. I want to chill. I want to just chill, and I want my money on Friday. Oh, you know what I'll probably do? I'll take all this money, the $76,000, and take it, and you go buy SoFi WKLY or TGIF. TGIF. There you go. TGIF will solve all my problem. They pay me weekly dividends. So, but like I said, once again, it's all personal preference. It's all up to you how you want to do it. It's really how you want to receive your money. I hope that helped a little bit. All right, so tomorrow morning, I got to close this event here because I got to go get some sleep. Tomorrow morning at 4:00, the stock market's going to open. And at 4:00, this price here, 1845, what's the calculator? Let me see, 1845 minus 93, 18.93. What? How did I screw up? 18.45 minus 0.93 cents. 1752. Is that the right price? 1845? I think I need to. Yeah, 1845. 1844 is after hour. Alright, so anyway, 1752 will be the price for at 4 o'clock in the morning. And at 7 o'clock, I'm going to put a bid for it. At this point right now, my decision point is either I just spend this amount and just leave it alone, or I spend roughly $10,000 and leave it alone, because the reason is Tesla's going to pay me in 2 weeks, so I can just use the Tesla money, or just spend this money and don't go into debt anymore. Don't use the margin. I'm going to be honest with you right here. I'm probably just going to spend this amount, $7,000, all right? And Clip's going to pay me. I don't know when I'm going to receive. Let's say I receive the money at around noontime from Clip tomorrow. Well, I'm going to take that Clip money, and I probably end up buying JEPY. I don't have JEPY or IWMY, so because that's the other fund I need to grow also. So. And that price is going to drop also. So I'm going to end up buying. So the clip dividends that I will receive tomorrow, I'll probably use that money to buy JEPY or IWMY. Okay, so that would complete that. So essentially what's going to happen, like 3 years from now, I'm going to get $3,000 in the first week. $1,000 from QQY, $1,000 from JEPY, and $1,000 from IWMY. So that diversified defiance. And then I'm gonna get maybe $3,000 from the yield max, $3,000 or $4,000 from yield max. So $2,000 from Tesla, that's not gonna change that much. And then I'm gonna get the Y max and the Y MAG, you know, the two new Y max. So that's gonna get roughly $3,000 to $4,000 from that, and then I'm gonna put a lot of money into Curve. That's to pay the third week's Clips. We don't. I probably keep Clip until Rexia come out. So whatever Rexia come out, and I put in there too. There's not. I don't want to buy any more of those 20 cents dividends. I already did that. The RYLD, XYLD, the CLM. The S vault at 30 cents or less, it's just yucky for me now. I'm looking at 50 cents or higher. If you don't pay 50 cents or higher, I'm probably not even gonna buy it. The other thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna continue to buy SoFi because they're pretty cheap. So I'm gonna keep buying maybe 100 share is about $700. So maybe 50 share a month. That's it. You know, no matter what the price is, every month that I get paid. Maybe I get paid from Tesla. I'm going to take some of that money and buy SoFi and continue to grow that fund. And then Tesla, when every time this thing drops before 216, I will buy it. But right now it's high. I'm going to keep Tesla. That's only to keep my girl happy because she want me to buy Tesla. But I don't think I'm going to put any more money unless Tesla price drops to 216, then I buy it. The other thing is, I'll take a look at other stocks to own also. Like, I'm thinking about owning NIO. I'm thinking about owning Rivian. You know, so some of all the newer technology. I may just go look at Cathie Wood and just cheat. You know, because she has a lot of stuff that it's pretty interesting. Like Roku is pretty interesting. Zoom Video is pretty interesting. UiPad is pretty interesting. I don't know about Block. Some of these guys are pretty expensive. And Unity Software. This is a gaming company. DraftKings. I love DraftKings because if you like gambling, you like DraftKings. Roblox, another gaming company. So does she have a teenage kid or something? Like, why is she really into gaming company? So I don't know. But I want to take a look at some of these technology. Palantir. I'm thinking about owning. I probably buy more something similar to what she's looking at and do some research and expand this. As you can see, Tesla so far, you can see there's some common trend here. And the next one is probably NIO. And as you know, they don't pay dividends. So what happened is my portfolio now is transitioned. Instead of buying common stock dividends, paying dividends, all my dividends going to come from the ETF, really my income. So that's something I'm going to play with in 2024. Okay. So with that, I'll let you all have the last word. Does anybody want to have the last words before I log off?
I have a question.
Yeah.
Shipping. Are you buying shipping?
I sold it. I sold everything.
Are you planning to buy?
Oh yeah, yeah. I do. I like shipping. I think I'm gonna reattack shipping after 2025. Because after 2025, I'm gonna get almost $7,000 a month. I'm on pace to get $7,000 a month. I can't imagine me not making $7,000 by the end of 2025. With $7,000 a month, man, I don't even know what to do with the money. Tell you the truth, I really. Yeah.
Did you sell CLM and like everything?
Yep, I sold everything.
So you don't want to? Yeah, you don't want it anymore, or not right now, or what?
It's just not right now. Do I?
So then
do
what's
I?
What's your plan then? What are you gonna buy? Just like Jeppy, QQY?
No, none. Jeffy. I'm just gonna none of those. I'm gonna take a look at it again after 2025. So after 2024. I'm sorry, after 2024. So going to 2025.
Okay. So what are you planning to buy with your dividends every month then? What are you buying?
Oh, just I'm buying QQY, JPY, and IWMY, and then the Cove. The TSLP, which paid the third week. And then, of course, I'm going to keep growing Tesla. I'm going to keep growing Clip. So right now, I'm getting $1,000 a month. But eventually, but I'm not going to grow as fast rate. Because all my money, all my dividends is going to QQY. But anything extra, I will throw it in to Tesla, to Clip, and stuff like that, you know. I don't have an allocation plan. Like some people have an allocation plan, they're very strict. Like 30% of the money go here, 10% of the money go there, 20% go here. I just have gut feelings. That's all I do. So like for example, when Tesla paid me on December 18th, that's $2,000. A, I can buy Tesla, you know, dividends, or B, I can buy Clips price before the X date, or C, I just keep that $2,000 and buy QQY. You know, and so I have like three options. But once QQY reach $1,000, I don't have to do that anymore. When I say $1,000, you notice I didn't say 1,000 share. I need to reach $1,000. So whatever the threshold, just like what Joanna say, is you got to have a buffer. So essentially, I probably need about 1,300, 1,500 share. That means if QQY dropped to 58 cents, guess what? I still get $1,000. No matter what situation, I get $1,000. I want to do exact same thing for all my funds here. Those are my income funds. Okay. I hope that clarified. Did that answer the question, Joanne? Or Joanna, you still there? Oh.
Yeah. Thank you.
Did you have a concern with that? Because I sold your favorite fund, CLM. I had a lot of share of CLM. I had 100 share.
No, because it's not my money. So that's the other thing that people need to remember. Everyone will do what they want with their money. And your plan doesn't have to be my plan. I'm not your financial advisor. So if it works for you, then do that. Don't worry about what I'm doing or anybody else is doing. Because everyone has different goals and timeline and risk tolerance and everything, right? So I like CLM. I have owned it for a couple of years.
Mm-hmm.
But that doesn't mean you have to have it.
Yeah, if I have a choice between something pay 12 cents and something pay 58 cents or 70 cents, I at this point right now, I'm okay. So here's something to think about. This is why I did this for January. I'm going into January like this, because when I start with January, all I had last year was Tesla, all in on Tesla. I literally had all in on Tesla. Well, in January, I don't have to go all in on Tesla. I have three funds now. So one fund Tesla got me $76,000. I grow my portfolio, but now I have 3 funds in January to grow my portfolio. So I'm really happy because I don't know what the end of 2024 look like, but guess what? I got 3 major funds that pay me good income. So I'm really, really happy. I'm getting $4,000. I'm going to get $4,000 a month. So, here very shortly. All right, that's all I have. If you don't have anything else, I'm going to go ahead and shut down here. It was really nice to talk to all of you, and I appreciate it. With that, take care, everyone. Oh, Sunday is the next live stream. See you on Sunday. And for those who are in our Discord, hanging out in our community, I'll see you every day. These guys literally on every day now, Joanna. Is that crazy?
They're in there like all hours. I don't think some of these people actually sleep. It's pretty funny.
Yeah. Yeah, go ahead.
There's always somebody to talk to.
I'm sorry. Who? Desperado, do you want to say something?
Hey, Cameron, can you hear me?
Yep, I can hear you.
Yeah. Hey, so I just want to introduce myself to the group. I know you have to go.
Yeah.
I've been listening to your YouTube videos and everything. You know, kind of like on the same path. I love the get together. But I finally had the chance to come on your channel live, man. So I'm in the army right now, I'm active duty. So I finally got some time. I'm on my way driving home. So I said, you know what? Let me catch him real quick and see if I can jump on the train and introduce myself. So I went in all in on QQY this morning. Should have waited till tomorrow to buy some, but the heck, I still have some money. I'm just going to DC it down tomorrow. I created a margin debit balance about 13 grand, but I'm not even worried about it because the payment that I'm going to get from QQY, and I'm planning on putting in $1,000, would be like $2,500, you know, just eating away that margin debit balance. But plan, you know, and then when I move up with that, I just use some more and open up some other positions, YMAX and, you know, maybe IWMY. But that's the goal. I don't want to keep you any longer, brother. I know you're in the Marines and everything like that. If I'm not mistaken, you're an officer, but I'm not an officer. I'm just an E6, you know, just trying to do my thing.
Yeah, no problem, man. You know, the goal here is for us to be financially independent. So that does not need ranks. That does not need education. You don't even need to speak English to be rich here in the United States. So you don't, there's no immigration status. There's no, doesn't matter what your family background is. Doesn't matter you're rich, poor, black, white, what your religion is. One thing we all have in common is that we don't want to work for the rest of our life. We want to be able to be financially independent, so we want to be able to travel, explore, and most importantly, to do all those things with your family, you know, with your husband, wife, and kids, and stuff like that, you know, whatever you have. And so as a result, I want to hear your story too, and I think we all want to hear your story, and so we want to share each other's story, because this is how we learn this, and I learned so much more than anything else, you know, it's just having the dialogue and conversation. Now, most of people only see this YouTube during the live streaming when I broadcast to the YouTube space. We actually online all the time. So if you come to our Discord, like you're in our Discord right now, there's always somebody in here talking. So as soon as I shut down here, the live streaming, these guys are going to start talking because the reason they're not talking is they don't want to go on live stream and hear their voice, you know. And I totally understand that. So, but as soon as I end the live stream, you're gonna see them all gonna having all kind of discussion about all kind of things. So let's do that. Let's go ahead and end the live stream. Hey, thank you everyone for watching. Please subscribe. Please comment. Yeah, I'll see you on Sunday. Peace out. All right, let me stop the recording.